Morning and thanks for joining us today. Today's webinar is the 2023 Grantee Manual Session 3. We have about 50 individuals that have registered for this webinar, and you know, about 25 so far that have joined. So we're going to give it a couple of minutes so that we can have the rest of the individuals join us. So it will be probably another 3 or 4 minutes before we start instruction. So if you could just please sit tight and bear with us for a minute. Okay, great. Thanks again for joining us today. Welcome to the Office of Illinois Works 2023 Grantee Manual Session 3. As you know, we have been doing an intensive onboarding process for new grantees This is the last session of the grantee manual series we're going to be delivering. We only have a couple of sessions left to complete the series. You have also had an opportunity already to meet with your assigned Illinois Works grant manager to continue the onboarding process, particularly the different steps that must be taken for the process. But we want to make sure that you have an opportunity to ask questions and go through the various sections of the grantee manual. And we definitely encourage you to, if you have not already accessed the grantee manual, to ensure you have access to it. It's located in the partner guide in the Illinois WorkNet system. And we will also be providing the link later during this webinar. Thank you again for joining us. The 2023 grantee manual is comprised of 14 different sections, which we are covering in three different webinars. This is the third and last of the three webinars specifically related to the grantee manual. The target audience for this program today include individuals that are accountable for data entry, data management, pre-apprenticeship program completion tracking, transition support, follow-up services, or any task related to maintaining contact with participants after graduating from your program. Job titles related to the target audience today may include the following: program administrators, program managers, program coordinators, training coordinators, transition coordinators, data entry coordinators, or anyone accountable for curriculum content or anyone accountable for program reporting. This session again is the third and final session of the three-part series that reviews each section of the 2023 grantee manual to ensure grantees can effectively implement their programs. Sessions one and two were covered last week and the week before, and they both combined cover the first eight sections of the 2023 grantee manual. This webinar is the continuation of the series and will cover the remaining six sections. So as you can see, we have a lot of content to cover, a lot of information to provide, and we want to make sure you have an opportunity to ask your questions or make any comments as we move forward. My name is Norman Ruano, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Office of Illinois Works, and it's a pleasure to be here with you today. Today, delivering this webinar, there are several of my colleagues that will be joining. So I want to first introduce Dr. Gia Suggs from Northern Illinois University, who will be delivering part of this webinar. Gia, if you could please say hi to our audience.
Hi, everyone. Welcome. It's really good to be with you all again.
Great. Thank you, Gia. Also with us today is Dr. Vera Lee Robinson, who's also with Northern Illinois University, is one of our program coaches. Vera Lee, if you could please say hi to our audience.
Good morning and welcome back.
Great. With here today also are two of our technical support managers from our accountability office who will also be delivering some of the content. We have Sue Writings and Amber Brutton from the accountability office at DCO. Sue and Amber, if you could please say hi to our audience.
Hello, everyone.
Hi, everyone.
Thanks again, Sue and Amber, for joining us today. We really appreciate it. The Illinois Works has a team of passionate professionals. Most of you have been in contact with some of us, know us, have met us personally, either through negotiations or through some of these webinars. We'll have an opportunity to share individually during our regional meetings and also our annual conference. But I wanted to emphasize who those individuals are so that you can develop some acquaintance with them. So again, Norman Ruano. I'm Norman Ruano, and I'm the Deputy Director of the Office of Illinois Works. Then you also have Christine Flynn, who's our Grant Management Analyst. You have been meeting, some of you have been meeting with her this week and last week related to onboarding. Then we also have Dan Martinez, who's also a Grant Management Analyst, and he has also been meeting with you and will be in communication with you on a weekly basis. Then, as I mentioned, we have Dr. Gia Suggs, who's with Northern Illinois University as a training analyst. And then we have Dr. Vera Lee Robinson, also from Northern, as a program coach. So that's the present team. There may be some additions to this team as we move forward in the year, but I want to make sure that you know who the team is and who you're relating to. As you know, Illinois Works was created as a result of Governor Pritzker's historic $45 billion capital plan and his commitment to expand equity in the construction industry workforce. As an Illinois Works Works grantee, you are now part of an exciting new initiative that will create opportunities for Illinois residents, businesses, communities, and families. Illinois Works consists of three key programs. We continue to emphasize this because it's very important that you know that is not just the pre-apprenticeship program. The three Illinois Works programs work together to bring about this change of equity in construction, okay? So the first program is the apprenticeship initiative. We already covered that in one of our training webinars before. The Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program is the second program that was implemented, and that's the one that you're part of and that we have been training you on. And then the third program is the bid credit program, which we have already put out some of the components of that program, but the full program will debut soon in this year. This training is the third of a three-part series that reviews each section of the 2023 grantee manual to ensure grantees can effectively implement their pre-apprenticeship program. So over the next 3 hours, and I want to emphasize this course will take 3 hours, we will cover the next six sections of the 2023 grantee manual. If you have not accessed the grantee manual, we are now providing the link for you in the chat so that you can just save that link and access the grantee manual. So the sections that we'll be covering today include section 9, which is professional development and technical assistance. Section 10 of the manual is the grantee's data management. Section 11 covers finances, records, and reports. Section 12 is using data for program management and improvement. Section 13 is programmatic monitoring. This is one of the key sections of this manual. And then the last section is audit requirements. That's what Sue and Amber will cover for us later on. In terms of objectives today, at the end of this webinar, you'll be able to describe the strategic role of professional development and technical assistance to support program success. You'll be able to adhere to the guidelines of your program's track. You'll be able also to incorporate the Illinois Works data management process into your program processes. You'll be able to enter data from each data category into IWRS. You'll be able to utilize record keeping. If you can go back for a minute, Gia. Record keeping, best practices. Next, please. Maintain, you'll be able to maintain participant files, very important for monitoring. You'll also be able to access GATA standard reports. We're going to discuss the two GATA standard reports and when they're supposed to be submitted. You'll be able to comply with the Illinois Works payment and model guidelines. You'll be able to effectively use data to support program management. You'll be able to incorporate continuous program improvement, the continuous program improvement model that we use, and you'll be able to adhere to Illinois Works programmatic monitoring. And finally, comply with the appropriate audit requirements. Please, just as a reminder, this course is being recorded and will be made available to all of you in the next couple of days through our partner guide. We are now dropping the link to the partner guide in the chat so that if you want to access it and listen to it, watch it in the future, you can certainly do that. In this same partner guide, we have all of the recordings that we, for all of the webinars that we have delivered so far in the year, and you'll be able to also find there all of the recordings for all of the webinars and lunch and learns and other activities that we'll be holding throughout the year. Any questions or comments before we proceed to the next section in our webinar today?
There are no questions or comments.
There's any questions in the chat, Gia?
No, there are no questions in chat. No.
Okay, great. Thank you, Verily. Appreciate it. So moving on to module two of this webinar. By the end of this module, you'll be able to identify and follow the you know, who the session participants are. It's very important for us to get to know each other, develop a community, leverage each other's resources so we continuously ask who's present so that you know who's present and who's operating in different parts of the state. Based on who the audience is today, use the WebEx features and functions to fully participate in the training, and also identify what you hope to learn today. As you know, we use a feature with Illinois Works modules for interactivity, and the tool that we use is called Mentimeter. So we will once again use this tool, and we ask you now to please log on to Mentimeter. If you could please go to www.menti.com and enter code 53826495. Again, www.menti.com and enter code 53826495. This technology allows us for you to fully participate in the training and also to provide feedback at the end of training related to the evaluation that we'll be conducting at the end of this session. So if you could please access that, I'll give you 1 minute to log on to Mentimeter and enter the code so that we can start the interactivity with this course. Okay, great. So what I need you to do in Mentimeter, if you could please enter your name, the organization or agency that you work with, the role that you play in that organization, the geographic location where you are located within the state, and as importantly, if you attended session one of the grantee manual, if you could please put an asterisk next to your name. But if you attended session one and two, please put two asterisks so that we know if you have been with us in the past. So again, go to Mentimeter, log on. Mike from Hire360 is here with us today. He's been here with us two times, and Mike is located here in Chicago. Anybody else, please, Mentimeter. So, Gia, can we see if there are more participants showing their information?
Yes, we can. I can refresh the screen. And also, there is a direct link in the chat for those who would like to use the direct link.
Great.
And it does show, Norman, that 20 individuals are actually in Mentimeter at this time.
Okay.
And actually, and counting, so it's probably just taken a few minutes. So now we have 22 individuals in.
So if you could please, again, log on to Mentimeter and provide your information, your name, organization or agency you represent, the role you play, location, and also an asterisk if you've been with us for the previous session, two asterisks if you've been here with us the two sessions. We're getting a message through the chat that they submitted their information, but it's not showing the Mentimeter, Gia.
Okay, let's do another update.
Is it possible? There you go. Mm-hmm. Marita from Project Hood in Chicago has been here two times before. Caps once before. Adam Lowell from Richland Community College, grant coordinator, has not been with us before. Michelle from DACC, also Danville, has been two times with us before. Daryl from CAPS, Chicago, has been here with us two times. Kendra from Tools Up, also from Chicago, has been with us two times before. Gina Taylor from Richland Community College has been with us two times before. Great, thanks for joining again. Linda Seawick, Belleville, has been with us two times before. Susette, ABC, Illinois, has been with us two times before. Merrick from Metropolitan Family Services, Chicago, also here two times before. Tiara from Youthville Lake County has also been with us two times before. Saya from Revolution Workshop has also in Chicago, has not been with us before. Taylor from Richland Community College, Decatur, has been with us two times before. William from Richland Community College, again, has been with us two times before. Mary Lou Noyola from St. Augustine College, Chicago, has been with us two times before. Felina from EDDR Chicago has also been with us two times before. Jermaine from TAKE has also been with us. This is the first time that he is, have attended session two, not one. So he's been with us once before. Rochelle from CAPS Chicago has been with us at least once before. Kashmir from Youthville Lake County has been with us two times before. Ashley, Rincon Family Services, has not been with us before. Tanya, Waken Foundation in Rockford, has been with us two times before. Joshua from St. Augustine College has been with us before. Deborah has been with us before two times from Rincon Family Services. Jackie from Macon County has been with us two times before. Deva Longoria from EDDR Foundation Chicago has been with us two times before. Thanks again for joining. Pearl from Impact Global has been with us before. I remember seeing Pearl before. Robert from Impact Global has not been with us before. Anita from CAPS Chicago has not been with us before. Jess from Richland Community College has not been with us before. And is that it, Gia?
That is it.
Okay, great. So thanks again for joining us. Given the number of people that have been here with us before, we are now going to be going over the WebEx tutorial. We will skip to the next activity in Mentimeter. If you could please, using Mentimeter, answer the following question. Is there anything in particular you're hoping we cover today? This is very important to us in case there's something that we're not covering today that you're interested in learning. We can refer you to particular resources or let you know when we're going to cover that. Rules we have to follow, that will definitely cover today. There's a lot of guidance that we'll be discussing today. Completion, we will definitely be talking about some of the requirements for completion. Changes to guidance, we will definitely cover some of the changes to guidance, particularly in relation to last year. Training, we will definitely talk about professional development today in our coaching system. Rules that need to be followed, as I mentioned, all requirements, yes, we'll definitely talk about those, particularly the ones related to sections 9 to 14. Anybody else, is there anything in particular you're interested in learning today? Please, if you could, make sure that you stay connected to Mentimeter. Mentimeter is going to be very important today as we deliver this webinar. Gia, are there any other responses? Okay, so here they are. process, yes, certainly. The process that is followed, how it relates to IWRS, the reports, we'll definitely talk about data and reporting, a lot of that information today. Regulations, we will definitely address lots of regulations today. Guidance. Let's see. Contacts, definitely you contracts. We will definitely cover how the contracts relate to the rest of the components of Illinois Works. There'll be particular sections where we talk about that. tracking. That will definitely be addressed today, how we track data and what we do with that data. IWRS, we will definitely discuss IWRS, but this is not an IWRS technical course. We just deliver an IWRS technical course, IWRS session 2. There is an IWRS session 3 that is preliminarily scheduled for next week, but there is another IWRS session coming up. So all of this stuff that you're mentioning, billing and reimbursement, we will definitely talk extensively about that. All of this stuff that you're mentioning, we will cover in today's webinar. So stay tuned, and we will be more than happy to address your questions or any comments that you may have. So thanks again for your participation there. We appreciate it. Now you're seeing the general email address for our Illinois Works office. If there are any other questions or comments that you may have, the best way to get a hold of us is to reach out to your assigned grant manager. By now, all of you know who your assigned grant manager is, or you can email us at ceo.illinoisworks@illinois.gov. Again, ceo.illinoisworks@illinois.gov. This is our general email address. It's manned on a daily basis, and anything that comes into that email box is routed to particular staff members so that you can get a response to any questions or comments you may have. Any questions before we proceed to the next section of the webinar? If you have any questions, please feel free to unmute your line or drop your question in the chat so that we can quickly address it. Vera Lee, any questions in the chat?
No questions in chat, Norman.
Okay, great. Thanks, Vera Lee. So now I'm going to hand it over to Dr. Gia Suggs, who's going to be delivering our next module in the webinar. So Gia, please go ahead.
Great. Thank you, Norman. So this is module 3, which will cover section 9, professional development and technical assistance. By the end of this session, you should be able to identify the professional development opportunities provided by the Office of Illinois Works, reference the expectations for each of the grant management tracks, save the date for upcoming professional development sessions, and ensure professional development offerings are responsive to linguistic and cultural needs. So let's take a look at Section 9, Professional Development, Technical Assistance in the 2023 Grantee Manual. Grantees must plan to participate in professional development and technical assistance. So for those of you who are familiar with the DCEO definition of technical assistance, this will be important because Illinois Works has its definitions for both professional development and technical assistance. So for Illinois Works, professional development is the culmination of tools, techniques, strategies, trainings, and group sessions that impact the knowledge, skills, behaviors, and attitudes of grantees with the goal of improving their performance and enabling them to successfully implement their Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program. Technical assistance is a one-on-one or small group intervention that helps ensure program fidelity and compliance with the end goal of supporting program success. So to ensure program success, Illinois Works provides a robust catalog of professional development and technical assistance offerings. So of course, webinar sessions, which you all have been participating in during this onboarding process, program coaching, Toolbox Tuesdays. So for 2022 grantees, you will know these as the Lunch and Learns. We have regional meetings that we're implementing during 2023. These are biannual in-person full-day professional development gatherings for grantee staff members and administrators. They promote networking among grantees and provide updates on the Illinois Works guidance as well as IWRS. The schedule for these meetings will be available in the Illinois Works program guide, and they will be located in different parts of the state. So you want to be mindful of watching out for those dates and times. Of course, technical assistance, and we also offer an annual conference. To learn more about the offerings and any additional onboarding sessions, please see Table 19, Table 20, and Table 21 in your 2023 grantee manual, and those are located on page 143 through 145. So let's start with the professional development high-level overview. So grantees are required to ensure appropriate staff participate in each of the professional development opportunities, as well as ensure there are appropriate budget line items to support participation. So for example, travel expectations for either the regional meetings or the conference. Webinars are each designed to provide grantees with information on how to navigate IWRS, which some of you inquired about during opening session when we asked what you wanted to learn more about, utilize the Illinois Works grantee manual, which is what we're doing today, and implement critical program requirements, such as obtaining certifications for the pre-apprenticeship instructors, providing effective transition services, and utilizing data to create a program improvement plan, which we will talk about shortly. Webinars are a requirement, no exception, for all grantees, irrespective of their track assignment. I will talk more about track assignments in just a second also. So we will start with the Illinois Works webinars. Webinars are professional development opportunities conducted over the internet. Illinois Works webinar sessions may include, but may not be limited to, trainings, information sessions, or conference sessions. Webinar sessions will be recorded and made available through the Illinois Works Partner Guide unless we note to you during the session otherwise. You can view the current webinar schedule, register for a session, or access recordings at the Illinois Works Partner Guide. And we are actually going to share a link for you to the Partner Guide in the chat. Next is program coaching. Program coaching is a tailored engagement between a professional program coach and a grantee. This opportunity allows you to receive individually tailored support with the goal of mitigating or preventing program challenges and proactively promoting program success. It is important to note that Illinois Works program coaches are not programmatic staff, so they cannot assist with actual program delivery. This is reserved for mitigating future challenges. The goal of program coaching is to provide you with customized support, and this support is available in three different domains: instructional certification, the pre-apprenticeship life cycle, also called program coaching, and business development. The Illinois Works coaching domains address 30 different coaching needs. So for more information about each of these domains, you can see table 22 in your 2023 grantee manual on page 146. Program coaching is required by the Office of Illinois Works for Track 2 grantees and provides an opt-in option for Track 1 grantees. So program coaching is tailored to provide proactive, preventive, one-on-one support driven by a needs analysis and coaching plan. Approximately 75% of program coaching support is proactive and about 25% is reactive. The Illinois Works program coach partners with individual grantees to help support program success and to ensure alignment with their Illinois Works grant expectations. Illinois Works grantees are contractually required to comply with coaching expectations. If you want more information about the Illinois Works coaching program, please see page 147 in your 2023 grantee manual. So a few times here, I have mentioned track designation. So let's talk a little bit more about that. Grantees will be assessed for program readiness. Grantee track designations will be the result of a comprehensive needs analysis process that considers the available information resulting from your NOFO and contracting process. Renewal grantees will also have the additional benefit of having their previous year performance outcomes to help inform their current track designation. The needs analysis produces red flags, which are warning signs that indicate there may be a potential performance concern. the needs analysis documents and information sources to determine your track designation may include, but not be limited to, the internal control questionnaire, the Illinois Works programmatic risk assessment, your NOFO reviewers' application evaluation scoring sheet and their respective notes, the Illinois Works coaching needs assessment questionnaire, which you should have received this week. It could be per the direction of the Illinois Works Deputy Director, and for renewal grantees, they have the additional benefit of having their monthly compliance reports and their prior year performance outcomes as part of this evaluation process. In addition, Illinois Works considers program development, longevity, capacity, and experience relevant to construction and the building trades. Once the information from each of these data sources has been analyzed, the track designation for the grantees will be established as either track 1 or track 2. Table 23 in your grantee manual provides a track description, and it's available on page 148. So I have mentioned both professional development. Well, let me now talk about professional development and coaching plans. So at the end of the needs analysis process, grantees will be identified as either track 1. And if you are track 1, you will receive recommendations for your professional development plan. And I will give you a resource for that in a second. If you are identified as track 2, you will actually receive a coaching plan. Again, track 1 grantees will receive an internal professional development plan. And then track 2 will receive a coaching plan. And again, you are required to participate in coaching. Track 1 has the option of opting into coaching. Track 2 grantees are allowed up to 10 hours of coaching per month. So for more information regarding expectations of track designations, again, see table 23 in your grantee manual. For more information about the Illinois Works Professional Development Plan, see template 20. Template 20 is actually available in the appendix of your 2023 grantee manual. The Office of Illinois Works will also host a 2023 Illinois Works annual conference this upcoming fall. The conference is an event that provides an opportunity for industry subject matter experts and program practitioners, which are you, the Illinois Works grantees, to share and exchange ideas, information, experiences, new technologies, and theories, among other things. The target audience for this event are Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program instructors, staff, administrators, and relevant partners. The conference can be either on ground or virtual or a combination of both. It just depends on what might be occurring. Of course, we all know that during COVID, a lot of activity went virtual. This year, we are planning for our conference to be on ground and face to face. And again, make sure that you have the appropriate line item in your budget for relevant individuals from your program to attend the conference. And then lastly, in our graphic here, let's talk about technical assistance. Technical assistance is a process of providing targeted assistance to grantees with the goal of program performance improvement. While the aim of program coaching is prevention and mitigation, technical assistance aids in course correction. Let's back to that, proactive mitigation, a reactive course correction. To help ensure programs are aligned with the Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program requirements and guidance, grantees will receive one-on-one intervention, corrective action, and compliance support. Technical assistance helps grantees meet critical milestones for the successful implementation of their pre-apprenticeship program. If technical assistance is necessary, you are required to participate. Let me talk a little bit more about the differentiation between coaching and technical assistance. So at a very high level, Program coaching is preventive, which is kind of mitigation, while technical assistance aids in course correction. Program coaching is scheduled regularly, again, up to 10 hours a month, while grantees will be alerted if technical assistance is necessary. Program coaching is primarily proactive, while technical assistance is reactive. And program coaching is delivered by independent consultants, while technical assistance is delivered by Illinois Work grant managers or other relevant Illinois Work staff. Additional information around the differentiation between these two is available in Exhibit 13, Program Coaching versus Technical Assistance, and it is available in the appendix of your 2023 grantee manual. So earlier I mentioned your internal professional development plan. So I want to spend a few seconds talking about the plan. Illinois Works understands that its program requirements are part of a new model for many grantees. So as a result, we have implemented a robust professional development agenda that includes webinars, coaching, technical assistance, regional meetings, and conferences. However, you as the grantee know your instructional and program staff. So as a result, grantees should leverage their institutional knowledge to develop an internal professional development plan for the specific needs of your program instructors and staff. Keeping in mind that the needs analysis results for Track 1 grantees, you will receive recommendations, even though you will not be required to participate in coaching, you will receive recommendations regarding specific focused areas that should be incorporated into your internal professional development plan. For more information about Track 1 internal professional development plan recommendations, you can see page 149 in your 2023 grantee manual. An internal professional development plan outlines the development criteria for all staff. At a minimum, it should be, it should include, but does not have to be limited to, the title and role expectations of staff members, professional development that's necessary, any events or programs that would respond to those professional development needs, and the approved program staff to participate in those events. Table template 20 provides a sample internal professional development plan, and it is available in the appendix of your 2023 grantee manual. So we're going to go back to Mentimeter. If hopefully you're staying at staying in Mentimeter, because we're going to be going back and forth to that forth to Mentimeter quite a bit, like we've done in previous sessions. And if you are not still logged in, the information from Mentimeter is available for you in the chat. And please answer this question: what type of professional development opportunities have you planned or are you planning for your staff? What type of professional development opportunities have you planned or are you planning for your staff? The required ones. Okay, perfect. What else? What else might you do as administrators to augment professional development opportunities that might be uniquely necessary for your staff? How to do documentation. Awesome. Thank you. What else? Meeting with other programs. Yeah, so partnerships are integral as a part of the Illinois Works program. How to answer questions. Yes, that seems like it would be intuitive, but actually how to be able to effectively speak to the Illinois Works program and respond to questions is critical. How to do reportings, yes, internal monthly lunch and learns, that is awesome. MC3 trainings, thank you. Accountability, yes. Meeting updates for systems. Yes, guest speakers, wonderful. So inviting in external subject matter experts to add to the kind of like your internal body of knowledge. Yes. Let's see, what else do we have here? How to partner with other organizations. Yes. Anything else? Illinois Works Annual Conference. Yes, it's going to be exciting to have you all there. Cultural competence. Given the target audience for the pre-apprenticeship program, cultural competence is a cornerstone. So yes. All right, awesome. Thank you so much for that. So let's talk about linguistic and cultural skills. And this back to the individual who shared cultural competence. It is cornerstone. Successful implementation of an Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program integrates diversity, inclusion, belonging, and equity, which is DIBE, with the goal of fostering an environment that allows individuals to feel safe, participate fully, develop professionally, and reach their fullest potential. Embedded in DIBE are linguistic and cultural skills, which should be included in your internal professional development plan. Linguistic and cultural skills are not just about translating materials or having bilingual outreach and recruitment staff. And this is important because even though your outreach and recruitment can incorporate materials in multi-languages and be delivered in a variety of languages, your actual instruction has to be delivered in English. It is the ability to understand the nuances of language and the cultural implications of potential participants throughout the Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship life cycle. Linguistic and cultural skills require program staff and instructors to refrain from judgment, be intentional about clarifying expectations, and always seeking first to understand. And just to let you know, there is more robust guidance around this topic in your 2023 grantee manual on pages 155 and 156. So I'm going to pause here before I hand this back to Dr. Ruano. Any questions about this section? Verily, is there anything in the chat?
No, there are no questions in chat.
Okay, awesome. Thank you all so much. And I will hand this back to Dr. Ruano.
Thank you very much, Gia, for the presentation here. We're doing very good timing here on delivering this very important content. We're gonna move on now to our module 4 of this webinar. And in this module, we're gonna be covering section 10 of the grantee manual, which is called Grantees Data Management. So the objectives for this module in particular have to do with articulating the steps, the three steps, the first three steps in the data management process, collect relevant data for each stage of the pre-apprentice lifecycle. We'll discuss the pre-apprentice lifecycle again in a minute, just for those that are new to our program. Identify data entry staff and also implement quality control measures to ensure data integrity. So that's the focus of this particular section. So again, section 10 highlights the data management process, the types of data grantees must collect and report, the role of the Illinois Works reporting system in doing that, and it discusses the importance of accurate record keeping. So data management, the Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship program strategically uses data in multiple ways. Why is this important? Data are individual pieces of facts, which when analyzed can provide Illinois Works and its grantees with valuable information. Data supports program outcomes. It also supports continuous program improvement. And lastly, it supports our longitudinal study, which is the evaluation methodology that we follow for Illinois Works. We have mentioned several times before, and it's important to emphasize here, that what we're trying to do, which is bring about equity to construction and the trades, it's a huge task, it's very complicated. And as a result, it takes good, effective programming, but also a coordinated effort and intervention to make this happen. As a result, having good effective quality data and knowing where we stand in very particular moments in time allows us to gauge how effectively we are doing our job and how effectively we're bringing about equity and inclusion to construction. Information is knowledge that can be used to understand program outcomes, uncover key insights and patterns, and contribute to informed decision-making. As a result, the effective use of data begins with a four-step management process for us at Works. So now using Mentimeter, again, as I mentioned, Mentimeter is going to be a key part of our delivery today. Please answer the following question. How is your program currently planning to use data? You know, we want to make sure that we continue to fund programs that are data driven and that use data. So if you could please answer the question, how is your program currently planning to use data? It's the next one, Gia. How's your program currently planning to use data? If you could please go to Mentimeter and answer the question, I would appreciate it. So you're planning to use it for tracking success. That's excellent. That is one of the main reasons why we use data. Track participants, yes, that's very important. We want to make sure that participants are fully tracked from the beginning all the way to the end, and even after they exit your program, up to 10 years. The success of your courses, yes, certainly you'll be able to track that, and you can use data to do that, to determine compliance. That is for sure. We're going to be emphasizing in a few minutes how we use that data to determine compliance. Transitions, yes. It's important. That data is going to be fundamental. Some of the dashboards that we have available for you will be fundamental as you do that. Monitor goals for best practices. Yes, certainly. Enrollment numbers. Yes, certainly. You'll be able to use data in IWRS and through the reports that we do for you to be able to do all of that. To make changes as needed. That is an excellent point. We will discuss how our data is used for continuous program improvement, which is one of the key philosophies in the Illinois Works system. Attendance, you could definitely use data to track attendance. We will discuss that, and as you attend our IWRS training, you'll be able to see how that gets done in IWRS. These are all excellent contributions. I really agree with most of these items that you are including here, and I appreciate you participating. So data management is the administrative process of acquiring, validating, and processing data. All data management for IWRS is housed in the Illinois Works reporting system. That is for the programmatic data. The financial data is not housed in IWRS, but we will discuss it is actually housed in our financial and grant management system for DCEO, but we will discuss how that data is reported very soon in this webinar. Illinois Works utilizes a four-step data management process, and I want to emphasize these four steps because what we have found is that if grantees do not follow these four steps, then they end up not producing the necessary data, and at the end of the day, their compliance gets affected because our model is so data driven. The first step is data collection. The second step is data entry. Third step is quality control. Here's where we saw a lot of challenges with other grantees. And the fourth step is accurate reporting. And all of these steps are fundamental. With accurate reporting, we'll discuss, particularly related to the standardized required PPR, PFR reports that are needed for Illinois Works, and the impact of not submitting or not submitting accurate reports can have on your program. Accurate reporting is the final step in the data management process. In many ways, it is the culmination of data collection, entry, and quality control efforts taken by staff throughout the entire process. Each data point, from grantee data to participant data, in some cases financial data, must be entered into IWRS timely and accurately to allow for live tracking, real-time reporting. of participant progress and program outcomes. It's important to emphasize that one of the negotiation items when you apply for your grant, and also as we negotiated your grant, was the type of staff that needs to be allocated to this program. One of the staff members that we discussed is as a data entry coordinator. Data collection is an established systematic process for accurately collecting data for the purpose of analysis to gain insights. The data entry coordinator is accountable for program data entry into IWRS. So you need to have a data entry coordinator. Now, that does not mean that you need to go hire someone new. You may have someone in your team that can play the role of a data entry coordinator, but it's very important that you have a data entry coordinator. The data entry coordinator can identify select staff to assist with entering data into IWRS. These staff members should have the appropriate skill sets for data entry and must be properly trained by the Illinois Works system. As you know, as we have mentioned, we have a variety of different webinars that we're delivering. The recordings will be made available in the partner guide. However, if there are new staff members that come on board and you need them to get trained, please reach out to the Illinois Works, to your assigned Illinois Works grant manager, who will then do one-on-one technical assistance with those individuals to ensure that they get the necessary training. Although several staff members may be responsible for entering data into IWRS, the data entry coordinator is accountable for ensuring the accurate and timely entry and reporting of the program's data into Illinois Works. So it's important that your data entry coordinator plays the key role that they need to have in this program. You collecting data and then not properly entering it into our systems or not reporting it to us is not going to help the compliance of your program. So please, using Mentimeter, have you identified a data entry coordinator for your program? You could please, using Mentimeter, answer that question. Have you identified a data entry coordinator for your program? We have 2 that are saying that they have, 4 that are saying that they have. So the majority of people are saying they have. Keep on please responding to see where we stand. I know that our grant managers have been meeting with your organizations, and one of the questions that is being asked is where you are with your staffing. One of those, obviously, staff members is data entry coordinators. So we have 12 of our grantees indicating that they have a data entry coordinator. We have 13 now. We have 1 that's saying that you do not have a data entry coordinator yet. If you have not yet identified a data entry coordinator, there is still time to do so. But it's very, very important that I emphasize this again. You need to find someone as soon as possible. That person needs to be trained and needs to get going from the very beginning. Otherwise, there's going to be all kinds of gaps in your data and your reporting to us. And as you will find out very soon, that will impact your compliance, and it will also impact the amount of resources, financial resources that are available for you to use on a monthly basis. So we have 13 that say that they have already identified someone, 3 that said that they haven't. I encourage those that have not identified someone to do so as soon as possible. The Illinois Works data will fall into 1 of 3 key categories: grantee actions, participant actions, and financials. Grantee data includes data regarding your engagement in the development, design, and implementation of the pre-apprenticeship program. Examples include number of participant cohorts, number of enrollees, and participants who complete the program. Participant actions data includes participant data which allows grantees to monitor participation, progress, and completion to help them take steps to ensure programs expand opportunity that result in an increase in apprenticeship participation and employment outcomes. Examples of this data include applicants, demographics of those applicants, attendance to courses, academic performance, how they did in those courses, and progress measures. Did they complete? Did they transition? Now, there's also financial data. Financial data includes grantees' actual expenditures in comparison to its allocated budget. These data are used to determine if Illinois Works funds are used for activities that are allowable under the grant, and leverage resources are used to support grant activities. As a note, financial data is not collected in IWRS, as I mentioned earlier. This data is submitted using the PFR, the Periodic Performance Report, which we will discuss soon in this training, but we do not collect financial data through IWRS. IWRS mainly collects programmatic data. If you have attended previous sessions, you may be already familiar with the pre-apprentice lifecycle, which is the model that we use in order to provide guidance, but also to indicate the type of required activities that must happen at each stage of the lifecycle. And this is a pre-apprentice lifecycle. This is the lifecycle that any individual that engages with your program would follow. It's important to keep in mind that through this life cycle, you'll be collecting participant data, and you also be reporting that participant data for that life cycle through IWRS. Table 25, called Participant Data Collection through the Pre-Apprentice Life Cycle Stages, is made available to you on page 159 of the 2023 Grantee Manual. Also, we have already provided guidance and training on how this would work. Both session one and session two of the Grantee Manual are available now on the Partner Guide. So if you want more information related to those, to the data and the different stages of the life cycle, I recommend that you go and watch those recordings so that you could really get some more in-depth information related to that. In terms of data entry, now we're going through the data management process. Data entry is the activity of entering data into a design designated computer software application for the purpose of data collection, monitoring, and analysis. While data collection is focused on the sources of information, data entry is where grantees demonstrate their progress and that of their participants using our reporting technology. Illinois Works is excited to provide grantees with live tracking of their progress through IWRS, which is the system that needs to be used real time to report your data to us. This tool can identify early program successes as well as performance gaps so that they can be quickly and efficiently closed. It is also important to note that outcomes and subsequent performance-based payments are based on data entered in IWRS. And this is what I was mentioning earlier, okay? We verify your outcomes and your performance and how we release funding for your program based on the data that you're reporting in IWRS. The University of Illinois Works cannot use any other information or data that is not in.
It seems we're having a little technical difficulty with Norman. If you can be patient, thank you.
Hi, Verity, can you please confirm if you can hear me?
Yes, we hear you fine, Norman.
Okay, great. I'm sorry, I apologize. There were some technical problems there. As I was saying, that we only can use IWRS data in order to verify your compliance on a monthly basis and to be issue performance-based payments. We cannot use any other source of data. So it's important that as you collect your data, that that data gets reported to us accurately and in a timely manner so that we can use that as we do our monthly compliance reviews and reports. We will discuss those in a minute, but I want to emphasize that it is only IWRS data that we can use. So for those reasons, accurate and up-to-date up-to-date data collection and entry is essential for your program. The third step in the data management process is quality control. Quality control is the process of regularly reviewing the data collected and entered into IWRS for accuracy. Accurate data collection and entry are essential to maintaining the integrity of the evidence is available on page 62 of the grantee manual. This table identifies data quality characteristics as well as examples for measuring the program's ability to demonstrate data quality control. So we encourage you to really take a look at that resource, table 26, to understand the quality metrics that we're looking at for your program. Now, it's important to know that you need to have an Illinois WorkNet profile in order to enter information into our system. The staff at the Center for Workforce Development at Southern Illinois University offers resources and ongoing technical assistance to all Illinois Works grantees. Grantees are required to have an Illinois WorkNet profile to utilize the IWRS system for programmatic tracking and reporting. So we encourage you, if you do not yet have an account with Illinois WorkNet, that you go and do that so that we can make sure that you're ready to report in IWRS. There is no limit on the number of grantee staff that can maintain a profile. However, let me just be very clear about this. It is important to remember that with more individuals entering data, there's a need for quality control. What we have seen from experience with our programs, when they use a diffuse model, a decentralized model of data entry, a lot of people entering data, quality and accuracy can suffer significantly. So as a result, it's very important that if you're going to use a decentralized model, which we do not encourage, we encourage you to use a centralized model where one or very few individuals are the ones entering data in IWRS. If you're going to use a diffuse model, or even if you use a centralized model, your quality control structure needs to be in place. So here's our recommendation related to quality control, and this is based on what we saw in our last program year in the programs that were effective at quality and entering data, and also in the quality of that data. So grantees are advised to have one dedicated person to verify accuracy of data on a weekly basis. This is very important. If you do it on a weekly basis, it would allow you to correct any deficiencies in your data. And also do a monthly check of your data prior to monthly compliance reviews. And that person who is doing the quality checking on a weekly basis and on a monthly basis should not be the same person who entered the data. So there should be someone else, a program administrator, some other person that is assigned to do the checking of the data on a weekly basis and then on a monthly basis, because the first week of every month, we will pull your data from the system and use that data to determine your compliance, and you will receive compliance reports, and we will discuss those in a minute. This ensures that the data is entered, adheres to quality standards, and it's entered real time, but more importantly, that deficiencies in data quality along with missing data are proactively and timely addressed. Again, by you having this step in your process, you will make sure that you can proactively address any issues that you may have with your data. Gia, I think that we have someone that is unmuted. If you could please make sure that we mute that individual, and also for the participants, if you can please make sure that as you come in to the webinar that you mute yourself so that we can eliminate background noise. Thank you.
Norman, you do have one question in chat. I think you have answered it, but just to reiterate for Mike, his question is, has any thought been given to revising the monthly compliance reports? For example, breaking down data by cohort or providing individual candidate information. He's saying that it can be very hard to determine where quality control issues may be arising when we only see a cumulative list of outcomes.
We can certainly discuss that further, Mike, in a separate meeting if you wish, but one of the things that we added to the monthly compliance reports is data trends. There's a whole section, a narrative section the report has, where we specifically as individuals, you know, that may be having issues, particular data trends that we're seeing. So it's not just the numbers that are being provided, but these reports, if a particular grantee has a lot of issues, we specifically identify issues per individual on that report. But as I mentioned, we can certainly have a conversation on the side about this if you wish. So the other thing that is also important is that the IWRS system offers several reports and also two dashboards that you can use as data sources for required reports. And this is all outlined in Section 11, Finance Records and Reports of the Grantee Manual. These dashboards are available at IWRS and will be discussed in Section 12 of this webinar. So we will talk about the dashboards and what those dashboards do to you. So if you have any questions related to this content of data management, please let us know. Enter your question in the chat, or you can unmute yourself. And we'll be more than happy to answer them before we proceed to the next section of the grantee manual. Any other questions, Vera Lee?
No questions in chat, Norman.
Okay, great. Okay, continuing on to module number 5, which is section 11 of the grantee manual, finances, records, and reports. In this section, you'll be able to differentiate between reporting and record keeping, reference tips for file organizations and maintenance, utilize the participant file checklist to collect and maintain required documents, comply with Grant Accountability and Transparency Act, which is GATA requirements, reporting requirements, accurately and timely submit required standardized GATA reports tied to your grant agreement, utilize the periodic financial report to submit monthly expenses. And we're going to spend some time here because we want to make sure that you're clear on how you're going to get paid and the reports you got to submit to get paid. Understand how the Illinois Works performance-based payment model was designed and how it's applied to grant reimbursement. Submit a performance-based payment appeal form in case you need to make an appeal. We'll talk about the conditions under which you can submit an appeal. And determine the appropriate use of funds, how to request in advance or request a budget modification, and how to establish a procurement policy. So those are the objectives that we have under Section 11. So this section will set expectations for record keeping and management, explore how to submit programmatic and financial reports, and teach the appropriate use of Illinois Works funds specially related to expenditures, and discuss budget modifications. So record keeping versus reporting. It is very important to know that Illinois Works only uses state funding. We do not use federal funding. The state funding that we use was appropriated by the General Assembly when the Illinois Works Jobs Program Act was passed in 2019. And because this funding is appropriated by the General Assembly, all Illinois Works grantees must comply with all state requirements related to record keeping and reporting. So again, this is all state funding. There is no federal funding here, but it's important to keep in mind that there are very specific record keeping and reporting requirements. Typically, one or more staff persons who are accountable for data entry are also accountable for reporting and record keeping. Record keeping is the process of ensuring the maintenance of the pre-apprenticeship records, including all required activities, transactions, and events. Reporting is the process of organizing records into topic-specific summaries that are used to monitor the program and determine if goals are achieved. Accurate record keeping is a prerequisite for effective reporting. Effective record keeping and reporting impacts a variety of different elements in your program. It impacts the documentation that needs to be kept for completed work. It impacts your program planning. It impacts your program operations, the evaluation of your program, ongoing monitoring and self-assessment, continuous program improvement. It impacts a variety of aspects of your program. So it's important that we really understand what is required here and what needs to be done. A record is a collection of related data items and or information, and a file is a collection of records with one or more common properties. In this case, the filing system that we require that is kept is a per participant file. So participant files should be organized and structured to facilitate compliance with the general requirements of the Illinois Works Pre-Apprenticeship Program. Grantees are required to keep all participant records and files for at least 3 years following the pre-apprentice completion or dismissal from the program. So let me emphasize that you need to have participant files, and those files, those participant files need to be kept for up to 3 years after they finish your program or are dismissed from the program. Now, those participant files need to be made available to us. IWRS will maintain significant information about participants, but any hard copies or records, such as program applications, age verification, high school diplomas, GED or HICET certificate, interview questionnaires, and career assessments, among others, should be maintained in the grantee by the grantee in the participants' files. We provide a tool for you as part of the grantee manual that you can use to organize those files, and that is Exhibit 7, which is called Participant File Checklist. It provides a list of all required records to include in your participants' files, and it's also available in the appendix of the 2023 grantee manual. So again, it's very important that those files are kept. They're kept accurately. If you accepted a participant into your program and you're saying that it's a requirement to participate in Illinois Works for them to have high school diploma or a GED certificate, you need to have records of that so that if, when we do field monitoring visits, we can have access to those records. Are there any questions, Vera Lee, before I proceed to the standard reports?
Yes, we have one question in chat. It's from Daniel Mendez. We planned on maintaining these files for up to 7 years. For clarity, is it 3 years or not 7 years?
For purposes of Illinois Works, it is 3 years after a participant exits your program. I know that a lot of programs keep their files for 7 years, and that's it's become pretty standard practice. So if you want to keep it for 7 years, that's perfectly okay with us. But for our purposes, 3 years are required.
No more questions in chat.
Great, thank you. So there are two required standardized reports that all grantees in the state of Illinois have to submit, and this is based on GATA requirements, and GATA is the Grant Accountability and Transparency Act. So the first of there, and these are, as I said, all state agencies, everybody has to use these reports, but there are two particular differences for these reports when it comes to Illinois Works. The first report is the Periodic Performance Report, which is a standard uniform statewide performance progress reporting format used by all state agencies to collect performance information from recipients of state grant awards. Now, typically the way this report is submitted is that, and this is outlined in your grantee agreement, is that they're due on a quarterly basis within 30 days of the end of each quarter, as outlined again in your grant agreement. So that's when this report gets submitted. Grantee performance data is tracked in IWRS. As a result, additional supporting documentation is not required for your PPR. So again, because you're reporting real time through IWRS to us, you do not have to attach anything to this report. You do have to submit it on a quarterly basis, but you do not have to attach anything to this report. You just have to mention on the report that all your reporting, your programmatic reporting, is being done by through the Illinois Works reporting system, IWRS, and you'll be fine with that report. Let me just mention something that is very important, because we've had the unfortunate situation where a lot of our grantees lose sight of reporting, of submitting these standardized reports. If you do not submit these standardized reports as required, your GATA account will be locked. And if your GATA account is locked, you are not able to receive funding from us. You're not able to receive payment from us. but you're also not able to receive it from on any other grant that you may have with the state. So it's very important that you really keep track of these reports and that they get submitted on time and accurately so that you don't end up in the unfortunate situation that your GATA account is locked, okay? So the second report is the periodic financial report. And again, this is a standard uniform statewide financial reporting format used by all state agencies to collect financial information from recipients of state grant awards. And Illinois Work is required to submit periodic financial reports. However, you know, there is one particular change here with this report. The PFR is how Illinois Works grantees will submit expenses on a monthly basis for reimbursement. Very important. This is not submitted on a quarterly basis. This is submitted on a monthly basis. The periodic performance report is submitted on a quarterly basis. The periodic financial report is submitted on a monthly basis. This report is due no later than 30 days after the end of the month. Why is this so important? Well, if you do not submit your financial report on a monthly basis, we have no other means of paying you. It's only through this report that we can pay you. You submit that report with the required attachments, and when you do that, then our Office of Grant Management can process your payment and request our approval on a monthly basis. We have some programs that have said, well, yeah, your guidance is on a monthly basis, but we're gonna do it every 2 months. Well, you can, but you're not gonna get paid on a monthly basis. You can only get paid on a monthly basis if you submit this report on a monthly basis. If you submit it on a quarterly basis, you can, but you're not gonna on a monthly basis. You're gonna get paid on a quarterly basis. So it's very important that if you do wanna get paid on a monthly basis, that you follow the guidance that is provided on the grantee manual. So detailed guidance related to these reports, you can find on pages 166 to pages 171 of the 2023 grantee manual. You will find the information that I just provided there. We also covered information related to these reports. We covered it in the administrator's orientation that we did early this year, and that recording is already available in the partner guide if you do want to get some more information. You can also find more information related to these reports in the GATA resource website. Vera Lee is going to be providing the link for you in the chat so that you can access the GATA resource website. You will find a lot of very valuable information there related to these reports. And if you do want more specific information related to these reports, you can communicate with your Office of Grants Management grant manager. And now let me just pause here for a minute because there are two different grant managers that you're gonna be working with as you are a grantee of Illinois Works. The majority of your work, and particularly in relation to programmatic issues, you're going to be working with your Illinois Works grant manager, Christine, Dan. You have already been meeting with them. You have been communicating with them. That's the majority of your contact with the Office of Illinois Works. When it comes to these reports and getting reimbursed, getting paid for your expenses, there is also an Office of Grant Management, Grant Manager. So the Office of Grant Management at DCEO is the office that executes, you know, that evaluates your reimbursements request and executes payment for your expenses. What they do is that they assign one of their own grant managers to work with you. So you have two grant managers, one from the Office of Illinois Work, you're gonna be working mostly with that person, and then one from the Office of Grant Management. Whenever you submit your request for reimbursements, they'll review them. They may ask backup information. They may ask other things that you need to submit. Once everything is clear, they send me an email requesting permission to execute a particular payment. Once I issue permission for them to proceed, they will proceed to issue payment for your expenses if they have found that your expenses qualify to be reimbursed and you have enough reimbursement in your account. So that's what the role is. We will talk a little bit more about, you know, how we release funding to your program, but I want to make sure that you understand that there are two grant managers, one from the Office of Illinois Works, which is your main grant manager, and then one from the Office of Grants Management, and that is mainly related to financial items and these standardized reports. Any other questions, Verilee, before I proceed?
No questions in chat, Norman.
Okay, great. The appropriate use of funds. Here's one of the key challenges that we have, and that is you submitted a budget, we reviewed your budget, we approved your budget. You need to make sure that you stay within that budget. We will speak about budget modifications soon, but you also need to ensure that you are appropriately using the funds. As with any grant funding, funds must be used for the purpose of implementing the Illinois Works Pre-Apprenticeship Program. Specific allowable grant costs were set forth in the applicable NOFO and in the Illinois Works Pre-Apprenticeship Program rules. It's very important to keep in mind that allowable costs include expenditures that must comply with 2 CFR 200. Explain to learn, and then it's very important for you to know that there are particular things that are allowable. And on page 171 of the grantee manual, we specify what those allowable expenses are. There are times when you will come across situations where you may have to spend other money, particularly related to wraparound services, that are not on the list of allowable expenses. Please contact your grant manager, mention what it is that you want to do, and they will let you know in writing if you are free to proceed with those expenses. The other thing that is very important, and I will really engage you in any questions related to this, because this became a real problem with a lot of our grantees last year. It has to do with budget modifications. So let me just be very slow here and make sure that we understand what we're talking about. If you need to modify your budget, you certainly can modify your budget, but you need to know how it works and the timelines that are followed for the budget modification. First, any budget modifications needs to be negotiated and approved first by your Illinois Works grant manager and myself. We are the ones that negotiate and approve budget modifications. After those budget modifications have been negotiated and approved by us, the budget modifications go to the Office of Grant Management for them to process them. And it takes 4 to 6 weeks for them to process a budget modification. Something that you should know is that once a budget modification goes to the Office of Grant Management, any expense reimbursements, meaning any payments for any expenses that you have out there, will not be paid out until that budget has been approved and entered in the state's grant management system. So in other words, when you submit a budget modification, we will let you know when you submit it. Yes, this is good, we can proceed, but be aware, it's going to be 4 to 6 weeks. And in those 4 to 6 weeks, you will not receive any payments. Okay. So that's the way the process works. Now, what we have seen is that a lot of grantees go first to the Office of Grant Management and tell them, oh, we want to negotiate a budget modification. And then they start that process with them. That's actually the incorrect process. You need to come to us first, the Office of Illinois Works, your Office of Illinois Works Grant Manager. We would negotiate that with you. We would approve it and then process it and send it to the Office of Grant Management. If you start with them, that's going to delay your process even more. So it's the wrong process. So I want to emphasize that with you, that you definitely need to start this process with us, okay? Program administrators, we're again providing data to the budget modifications and also the appropriate use of funding in the administrator webinar that we delivered. That webinar again is already available. But if you do want more guidance related to this point, you can go to page 172 of the grantee manual. Now we're gonna move on now to the last part of this particular module. So before we do that, let's again through Mentimeter answer a key question, and that is, who has previously managed a performance-based grant? Who has previously managed a performance-based grant? This is very important because Illinois Works is a performance-based grant, and we want to discuss that. And I want to make sure that I do justice with the time to answer any questions or comments related to this. Most of us probably have operated in non-performance-based grants, but Illinois Works, again, is a performance-based grant, as we indicated in the NOFO. It was made very clear during the technical assistance that we deliver after we release the NOFO before you apply for a grant with us. So based on the results that I see in Mentimeter, we have most of you have operated in a performance-based grant system, but there's a significant number that have not. So it's important for us, again, to go through all of the details. So for those of you that have not, this transition will be new for many of you who have previously received funding from DCEO through its programs and services. In fact, DCEO is quickly moving to providing performance-based funding for its programs. For those who are familiar with this type of payment model, it has a reputation for presenting certain challenges. Given this, it is understandable that you may have questions regarding the impact of this transition in this Illinois Works model. You will find that there are some components of the Illinois Works model that will be familiar and some that will be different. The DCEO Office of Illinois Works is highly invested in your success. As a result, the Illinois Works model has been structured accountability, the accountability that a performance-based model can bring, but at the same time, we create a structure that provides additional funding opportunities. So our performance-based model not only brings an added level of accountability, but you will find out in a minute that it also gives you an opportunity to make more money even beyond the amount that we originally allocated to your organization. So the performance-based model that we use at Illinois Works is rooted in the belief that grant funding should be based on an organization's tangible impact in the community. And we are serious about that, tangible impact. This is not just about going through the dynamics. This is about really having an impact in your communities and bringing about the equity and inclusion that we need in the construction industry. The combination of performance-based and reimbursement models means that metrics dictate the amount of available that is available for reimbursement for grantees, and then grantees must submit allowable expenses to access that funding. So let me just explain what this means, okay? So we have a performance-based model on a monthly basis, and we will discuss our monthly compliance review in a minute. But on a monthly basis, we will do a compliance review. And based on how well you're progressing towards meeting your goals, we will release a certain money, a certain dollar amount for our Office of Grant Management to pay to you. However, they will not pay you that money unless you submit expenses, okay, that are allowable towards that amount. So let's assume that we release $100,000 as a ceiling that the Office of Grant Management can pay you, and you submitted $75,000 worth of allowable expenses, they will pay you the $75,000 because you had a ceiling of $100,000, but you submitted $75,000. What happens if we release the ceiling of $100,000 based on your performance, but you submitted expenses that are worth $110,000. So what happens is that the Office of Grant Management will release $100,000 because that's the ceiling that you have. And the $10,000, they'll hold until your next performance review once you have performed at the level where we release more money for them, for your account. Then they will pay you for those extra $10,000, assuming those are allowable expenses. So it's a performance-based model, but you also have to submit allowable expenses that need to be reimbursed. You need to have spent the money first. It's a reimbursable system. All Illinois grants are based on a reimbursement model, okay? So any questions about that before I proceed to discuss how the details of how this model works? Any questions, Vera Lee?
No questions in chat, Norman.
Great, thank you. So, key aspects of our model. If grantees exceed their metrics, they can earn funding beyond their initial grant award. This is a very important point to emphasize. If you are a grantee that is high performing, you're doing everything that you need to do, and you are exceeding your metrics, you may end up with more money than we originally allocated to you. Meaning, if we gave you an original grant for $500,000, but you exceeded your metrics, you may end up with $525,000 or $550,000 that you can use in a particular program year. Due to live real-time reporting through the Illinois Works Reporting System, or IWRS, DCO will make disbursements on a monthly basis. So that's the other key aspect of our model, is that because you are reporting to us live, real time, and we are pulling that data on a monthly basis, we are able to release, you know, amounts for reimbursement to your account on a monthly basis. We don't have to wait 3 months or 6 months. This is a monthly basis system, and that's the reason why it's so important that you submit your periodic financial reports on a monthly basis so that you can get paid on a monthly basis. Grantees have the right to appeal to Illinois Works if a grantee believes that they missed their outcome metrics due to variables of their control. So there is an appeal component to our model, and you can certainly appeal. There's a process that needs to be followed, and I will discuss that very soon. And if you are granted the appeal, you know, you can certainly get the benefits of being granted an appeal. It's important to keep in mind that the only reason for you to appeal you not meeting required metrics is for variables that are outside of your control. An example of it, and we saw a lot of them in the last program year, a particular individual did not successfully complete your program because they were accepted into the Carpenter's apprenticeship program. Well, that's a great thing that happened because they got into the Carpenter's program, but as a result, they did not complete your program. Well, you can appeal that and indicate and provide evidence that that's what happened, and we will review it and then let you know if we grant your appeal. Okay, funding benchmarks. So we're talking about how our model works, our reimbursement model. So I'm going to go now into the details of this. Make sure that you ask any questions, or if you have comments, you let us know, so that I just want to make sure you really understand how this works. So there are four funding benchmarks that we use for our model. Enrollments, completions, transitions, and closeout reports. The funding that we provide to you is going to be divided into those funding benchmarks. And we will discuss in a minute the formula that we use and the amount that is distributed for each of those funding benchmarks. Each of these are connected to a percentage share of the overall grant award. Because this is a performance-based model and not an outcome-based model, organizations can receive reimbursement funds related to benchmarks while working towards their goal. In other words, you can progressively be working towards meeting those goals, and we will give you reimbursement while you're progressing to that. So let's assume your goal is to enroll 25 individuals, but in a given month when we pull your data, you have so far enrolled 10 individuals. We're not gonna hold reimbursement until you reach those 25, your goal of 25. We will release reimbursement if you, let's say, have 10, and then the next month, 5 more, we will release reimbursement for those 5 more, and then 5 more, and on we go. So every month when we check compliance, and you're progressing towards meeting that metric, we will release funding for that. Additional funding beyond your initial grant award is available if you exceed the outcome metrics based on your per participant allotment outlined on pages 163 to 165 of the grantee manual. So after funding benchmarking, you must then submit allowable expenses. So again, as I mentioned before, you may be generating a lot of funding based on your performance, but you need to submit allowable expenses for you to get reimbursed and tap into that funding. I'll tell you something that was unfortunate that happened last program year, and I really want to evade that happening this program year. We had a lot of programs. In fact, the majority of our programs generated significant amounts of funding because of their performance. And unfortunately, they didn't have enough expenses to use that money. So we have a lot of money that was left on the table, not because they didn't have the performance, but because they didn't have the expenses. They just didn't have enough expenses to be able to use all the money that they generated through their performance. So we want to emphasize this year for you to really budget accordingly and start processing all your expenses, start executing your expenses, hire the necessary people, do what you need to do and generate those expenses so that as you generate your performance-based revenue, you can use it for your expenses. We do not want to end up with $1 or $2 million in our hands of money that was generated but was not used because they didn't have expenses. Okay, so I want to emphasize that. Funding formula, how does the funding formula work? So our funding formula, as I mentioned, there are four benchmarks that we use. Next slide, thank you. So enrollment is 25% of your grant award. Completion is 30% of your grant award. Transitions is 35%, and then closeout reports is 10%. All of that adds up to 100%. You will notice that that will be clearly spelled out in your grant agreement, but I want to make sure that you understand how this works. So if you enroll people, let's assume that you enroll everybody that you need to enroll, you're going to earn 25% of your grant award. If you successfully complete the people you're required to complete, and we'll discuss in a minute what percentage you're required to complete, but if you successfully meet that, then you will get 30% of your award. If you successfully transition the number of people that you're transitioned, then you'll get 35% of your award. And at the end of the program year, you need to go through a closeout process. And if you successfully close out, you will get 10% of your award. Now, all of that, it's up to 100%. But some of these benchmarks, some of these metrics are more important than others. You will notice that it's incremental. Enrollment is important, but it's 25%. Completion is higher than that, is 30%, and transition is even higher than that, is 35%. And that is because our program is completely focused on ensuring that we successfully complete individuals and transition them to DOL registered apprenticeship programs and employment. So as a result, those metrics are going to have the higher allocation of funding. The per participant allotment is the result of the funding benchmark percentage divided by the funding benchmark participant goal. So let's do an example so you understand this, right? So let's assume that your enrollment goal is 25 participants, and the dollar amount based on your grant amount for that enrollment goal is $100,000. So then you divide the $100,000 by 25, and that gives you the per participant allotment for enrollment. So every time you enroll someone, we will, and we confirm that enrollment, we will release $4,000 for that individual. You enroll 10 individuals and they are all confirmed by our compliance reporting, then you'll get $40,000 release for enrollment, right? And we use the same process for completion, transition, closeout reports are a little different because you have to successfully go through closeout. It's not based on a participant allotment, but this is how enrollment, completion, and transitions work. This is how we calculate the numbers. The per participant allotment for a specific metric is multiplied by the number of participants who have newly met that funding benchmark at the end of each month. So we're going to be checking this on a monthly basis through our monthly program review that is conducted by our Illinois Works Grant Manager. We will discuss that soon. In this webinar, but I want to make sure that you understand how that works. And again, this performance-based model and funding formula is outlined in detail at page 173 of the grantee manual. We also cover this in the program administrator orientation, and the recording of that is already available for you in the grantee in the partner guide. Monthly compliance reviews, how does that work? At the end of each month, the Illinois grant manager will check each grantee's outcome metrics and based on the organization's progress, based on your organization's progress toward your goal, we will alert the Office of Grant Management of the maximum amount available for reimbursement. So as I mentioned earlier, we will do that check on a monthly basis and then release a certain dollar amount for the Office of Grant Management to pay to reimburse you for your expenses. And I want to emphasize what I mentioned earlier. Last year, our programs generated a lot more funding than they use. Let's make sure that that doesn't happen to you. Let's make sure that you're using your funding, that you're investing where you need to invest, so that as you submit your expenses, you're not leaving money on the table. We will review the monthly compliance review in more detail in section 13 when we talk about programmatic monitoring, but for right now, I wanted to mention that. So how do we determine then the monthly reimbursement maximum that you will have? The per participant allotment for an enrollment and completion is multiplied by the number of participants who have newly the funding benchmark stage at the end of each month, as documented by the monthly compliance review conducted by the Illinois Works Grant Manager. For transitions, however, the per participant allotment is separated into two portions based on the participant's progress towards a transition. A primary transition is awarded based on a two-step verification process containing a preliminary and a final step. A preliminary verification of a primary transition will be awarded 75% of the primary transition per participant allotment. When the final verification is completed, the remaining 25% of the primary transition per participant allotment will be available for reimbursement. Secondary transitions are reimbursed at 50% of the primary transition per participant allotment. And at this point, I want to emphasize that we have primary and secondary transitions. The Illinois Works Jobs Program Act mandates that our primary goal is to transition people to DOL registered apprenticeship programs. And that is the only primary transition that we can give you credit for. Transitioning to DOL registered apprenticeship programs are primary transitions. Anything else you do, transitioning people to college, transitioning people to other employment, transitioning people to other educational programs, those are considered secondary transitions, and we will give you some credit for it, but we cannot give you full credit. So if you do a secondary transition for an individual, that will only give you 50% reimbursement in comparison to the primary transition. So that's a very important emphasis. We exist to transition people to DOL registered apprenticeship programs. If that's not what happens with these individuals, your reimbursement for a transition will be considered a secondary transition, and you will only get 50% of what a primary transition will give you. We will also cover this in more information related to verification later in the webinar. If you want more information related to this in the grantee manual, you can go to section 13, which is programmatic monitoring. There's a whole section that discusses that. Closeout report is the last benchmark on the formula. So closeout report is the way we calculate that dollar amount is not related on a per participant allotment. Instead, they are based on grantees completing the required closeout reports, analyzing data entry in IWRS. In December, you will receive instructions on what the closeout process will look like, the deadlines that you have to finish that process, the reports you got to submit. And if you successfully do that and answer any questions our team may have related to your closeout, then we will release your closeout money. Typically, it's 10% of your grant award. At the end of each month, the Illinois Works Grant Manager will run a compliance report. This allows the Illinois Works Grant Managers to check each grantee's outcome metrics, and based on the organization's progress towards their goals, we will alert the Office of Grant Management of the maximum amount available for reimbursement. We provided a tool for you, Table 27, in the grantee manual on page 174. Table 27 is called Meet or Exceed Some Outcome Metrics, and it will give you all kinds of examples so that you can see how it can play out for your program. Again, the key here is to ensure that you are in good standing and that you're progressing towards meeting your goals. If you are, then you could certainly get all the money that you were granted, but more importantly, you can even get more money if you exceed your metrics. Performance-based payment appeal. As I mentioned, there is an appeal process that exists. Throughout the grant, there instances may arise when an outcome metric is impacted by circumstances outside the control of the grantee. And I want to emphasize this, we only consider appeals if the circumstances that cause for you to not meet certain metrics are outside of your control. These instances are primarily related to individual participant outcomes. In these cases, Illinois Works will accept an appeal from the grantee. Grantees are required to submit Exhibit 14, Performance-Based Payment Appeal Form. You can find Exhibit 14 in the appendix of the grantee manual. You could also find more guidance related to this topic on page 177 of the grantee manual. The appeal form allows up to 3 participant appeals per form. All relevant documentation should be submitted with appeal forms to ensure speedy determinations by Illinois Works. If approved, if you appeal with the required documentation and we approve it, the outcome metrics and related reimbursement will be detailed in the succeeding compliance review. So in the month after the appeal is approved, we will make the changes on your compliance reports and you will be able to see those changes there. Any questions?
Yes.
We give a break to our grantees and then when we come back, go to the last 3 sections that we have left. Any questions?
Yes, there is a question from Mike. Can you provide additional examples of circumstances that may be beyond our control? What thresholds do you look at to gauge this?
Well, I mean, you know, circumstances beyond your control are things like the example that I gave, you know, people transitioning, you know, to a DL Register Apprenticeship Program. We have seen instances where a particular individual comes into a program and then decides that because of their plans, their career plans, they had specified what they wanted to do, and now they have changed their plans, and as a result, they cannot they have to put on hold certain information or certain plan activities in their career plan, and it may end up that that results in them changing what they want to do. And it results in them not successfully either completing their program, and then they may come back to the program, and they already have certain employment. They might have completed the program somewhere else. We have seen they go from your program, put things on hold, and then they go and complete the program somewhere else, and then there's an appeal that happens as a result of that. We would definitely entertain reviewing those appeals if we have. But you know, there's a lot of instances that are new because the program is new that come up, and I would encourage you, if you do have an instance where you think it's beyond your control and you have evidence of that you submit it, we are keeping a list of instances that we have seen, so that every time there's a new instance, we document it just to make sure that if it comes up again, that we use the same parameters to evaluate. It's very difficult to discuss a standardized list of items related to this because each program is very different and operates in different regions with different circumstances. But we are seeing some very interesting cases that we certainly would discuss if you want to circle back about this, Mike. Any other questions, Vera Lee, related to this?
Yes, we have one other question before our break. It comes from Des. When it comes to staff and reimbursement, only 25% of grant will be paid until the threshold is complete?
No. I think that, so what happens, if you look at the formula that I discussed, you would notice that there is an enrollment carries 25%, completions carries 30, transitions carries 35. If you start rolling your program, you will notice that some staff will be allocated into enrollment. They're working on enrollment. Some staff are working on ensuring people are getting trained and completing. Some staff are working on their transitioning. So as you're meeting those different benchmarks, we're releasing money for each of those benchmarks. So if you had 25 enrollments, we'll release money for that. You can pay from that money that we're releasing for staff that are not working on enrollment. We are releasing funding based on benchmarks, but you use your money for your expenses based on your budget. So obviously you're still using space, you still have people engaged in transitioning, you still have people engaged in completion and case management. So you pay your staff out of that. But it's important to keep in mind that is the release of that money that is based on these benchmarks, right? So your enrollment, if you're meeting your enrollment goals, we're gonna be releasing money based on enrollments. While you're enrolling, you may also be running another cohort. And when you complete those, we will release money related to completions of those. While that cohort completes and they go into transitions, you may be enrolling for another cohort. So we're releasing money at the same time for completion and transition of one cohort and for enrollment of another cohort. So it's a very dynamic process. And as I said, you know, I know that one of the concerns that was brought up the previous year was, well, you know, I'm concerned about not generating enough funds and then not being able to pay my expenses. I can tell you the problem that we had was exactly the opposite. People generating significant funds and then not having enough expenses to be able to use that money. And as a result, I think there was like $1.5 million that was left on the table of money that was generated, but there were no expenses that these programs had to use it. So anything else? Any other questions, Verily?
Yes, there is. What is the best internal software that previous groups use for benchmarks? Salesforce?
So Des, I mean, that's a good question. There are a lot of programs, depending on the size of their of the program, that use different types of systems. Salesforce may be one of those systems used by some grantees. I can tell you the majority of smaller grantees do not have specific software that they use. As a result, IWRS is not designed only as a reporting platform. It's also designed as a grant management software. You could use IWRS to manage all the aspects of your program, from outreaching, so it can serve as a CRM system for outreaching, relating to potential participants, relating to employers, relating to DOL registered apprenticeship programs. And it also has other features that you can use as grant management. So it's not just a reporting system. It can be used as a grant management system. And a lot of the smaller programs that we have use it like that. The larger programs that have their own, you know, software and databases only report in IWRS and may not use all the capabilities of it. But it really depends where your program is and what you want to do. I would recommend, if this is fairly new to you and your program, that you use IWRS as a grant management system. Okay, any other questions?
No other questions in chat. Did you want to take a 5-minute break or 10-minute break?
We are actually going to take a 7-minute break. So we'll be back at 11:35 to start going through section 12, which is using data for program management and continuous improvement. So again, if you could please make sure you come back at 11:35, I would appreciate it. Thank you. Okay, great. Welcome back to the Illinois Works 2023 Grantee Manual Session 3. As we mentioned earlier, this webinar is going over each of the Grantee Manual sections. We just finished covering Section 11 of the Grantee Manual. We are now going to cover Section 12, Using Data for Program Management and Continuous Improvement. In terms of objectives, this section, after we review this section, you'll be able to understand the Illinois Works Continuous Program Improvement Model, utilize the Program Improvement Plan template to execute continuous program improvement for your program, apply each step in the performance management process, identify different approaches for pre-apprenticeship program evaluation, and also identify and also ensure all participants take the participant satisfaction survey and learn how to utilize the results of the survey to strengthen your program. Again, this is section 12 of the Grantee Manual, the 2023 Grantee Manual. I hope you had an opportunity to gain access to the manual and review each of those sections. There's a lot of information there, a lot of tools that are important for you to use. More importantly, it contains all the guidance related to Illinois Works. Grantees are accountable for program management and continuous improvement. Program management process in overseeing two or more related activities that have the same aim with the goal of compliance with program expectations, improving performance, and ensuring outcomes are met. Management includes a continuous program improvement process throughout the entire reapprentice lifecycle. The continuous program improvement is the ongoing assessment of performance outcomes with the goal of identifying opportunities for incremental and innovative enhancements during each of the phases of the life cycle. The continuous program improvement is an ongoing effort to improve services and program delivery. This is not punitive or corrective, it's about ongoing improvement. Continuous program improvement challenges grantees to respond to the question, how can we be even better? And that's one of the key questions and one of the key things that we want to continuously do at Illinois Works is how can we be even better? If we're already doing a good job in certain areas, or maybe all the areas or most of the areas, how can we be even better? And this is a very important question in light of what I mentioned our challenges. Our challenge is to bring about equity and inclusion to construction. That is a huge challenge. It's a decades old challenge. And as a result, how can we be even better? It's even more timely and more important. You are required to execute a program improvement plan every 6 months to communicate how service delivery practices can be improved for optimal program performance. Exhibit 9 in the appendix of the Grantee Manual, the Performance Improvement Plan, is available for you to review. This is the plan that needs to be used every 6 months to improve your program. Now, using Mentimeter, please answer the following question. How has your program previously used continuous program improvement models? Have you used continuous program improvement models? How have you used them? Again, going back to Mentimeter, we want to make sure we stay engaged through Mentimeter. How has your program used continuous program improvement models in the past? Just as well. You've used data from IWRS. Yes, this is very important. In fact, we're going to touch on that soon. Data from IWRS is very key to the program improvement model because you can really see where you stand in relation to your program. Anybody else related to this question? Okay, we only had 2 responses. If you could please make sure you log on into Mentimeter and you can engage. We have several other items coming up. You've used it to monitor the program. Yes, you can certainly use to see where you are in a particular moment in time in your program and have a plan on how you will address gaps. Exit goals of people. Okay, good. One of the key things about the Illinois Works Program Improvement Model is that it's designed to promote improvements to service delivery. So it's very important that you know, that you see this for what it is. It's, you know, we want to make sure that we're continuously improving and that we're doing better in what we do. So we're good now, we want to be excellent in the future. So we look at, through this model, we look at program performance, the degree to which grantees meet the objectives and achieve their goals. Program performance does just not consider what grantees accomplish, but how they accomplish that, the type of things, the type of decisions, the type of things they're doing to meet expectations, right? The other thing is measuring outcomes. Program performance is determined by measuring outcomes, which is a systematic way of assessing if programs have achieved their goals through the collection and analysis of data. Also, another part of our program improvement model is benchmarking against program goals. Continuous program improvement requires grantees to identify points within their program when actual performance is measured against performance goals, also known as benchmarking. Another important element is brainstorming opportunities for improvement. These are facilitated group discussions to see, search for new and innovative strategies to improve performance. Additional information related to brainstorming and effective steps and techniques there are included on page 183 of the grantee manual. Implementing new strategies is the last component, which is once the leadership team has identified new strategies to help close a performance gap, it must be put into action. I think it's very important that, you know, everybody is involved in this process. Everybody that is part of the program is involved, provides feedback, you know, to clearly identify what the gaps are and what the improvements could be. The improvement may be, you know, strengthening the way you relate to DOL Register Apprenticeship programs, or strengthening your enrollment process, or strengthening your instruction process, or your student support services. That may be for your program. Having everybody involved and having a way of closing that gap is going to be very important here. Gee, I'm going to skip the next activity. In terms of performance gaps, so grantees can benchmark their performance using a dashboard. So we have two dashboards I had mentioned earlier through IWRS that are available to grantees. One is called the programmatic dashboard, and the other one is called the follow-up dashboard. For information on how to access these dashboards through IWRS, I recommend that you go and review one of our recorded sessions. We just finished delivering an IWRS session where we talked about dashboards, and there's another IWRS session that is scheduled for next week. If you want to attend, we will also discuss some of that information there. Benchmarking dashboards allow grantees to visually see the comparative data between actual performance and program, exposing any performance gaps. The performance gaps are the difference between the program goal and the actual program performance. So you can use your dashboards as part of your program, continuous program improvement planning, to see where you stand. Someone mentioned earlier they use IWRS data. This is how you can use IWRS data for your program improvement plans. So let's talk about these two dashboards so that you can get more information about them. So the programmatic dashboard allows grantees to quickly identify key programmatic information. For instance, there are red flags in that dashboard. You can see red flags related to absences, either by an individual or a particular cohort, post-assessment information, any past due follow-ups that are due for with individuals. You could also see information related to intake, the status, the inquiry status of a particular individual, participants that were enrolled per cohort, participants that were not enrolled. All of that information, again, is part of the programmatic dashboard. You can also see participant engagement, number of active participants, training services being provided, open training services that are past due for attendance entry, wraparound services, student support services, transition services. That's part of what's included in the dashboard under participant engagement. You can also see earned credentials. So total participants who have earned a credential, the type of credentials they have earned per cohort, NCCR, NAVTU, ICCB, OSHA 10, First State CPR. You could also see completion data, participants per cohort that have an incomplete status, participants per cohort who have successfully completed, those that have not successfully completed. You could also see pre-apprenticeship program completion and transition services, those that have transitioned successfully, those that have not transitioned successfully. All of that information, again, is part of the programmatic dashboard. You can also see on that dashboard provider and employer-sponsored relationships, number of relationships you have with union apprenticeship programs, number of relationships you have with non-union apprenticeship programs, number of contractors or employers that you have relationships with, all part of that programmatic dashboard. Page 181 of the grantee manual provides more guidance related to this particular dashboard. In table 30, called the IWRS dashboard sections, programmatic and participant data also provides more information related to this particular dashboard. Also, this each of the metrics on the dashboard has a particular color associated with it, and each of the colors means a particular action that you may have to take. Red, obviously, meaning there's action needed. To this, please look at table 31 of the grantee manual on page 182. You'll be able to see it's basically information on what the dashboard means and the coloring system means. Table 31, page 182 of the grantee manual. The second dashboard that is available to you through IWRS is called the follow-up dashboard, which focuses on follow-up and tracking beyond participants' tenure in your program. This dashboard is post-program active tracking and long-term tracking. So you could see things here related to individuals that are already in a employed in construction, individuals that are on a waiting list of a DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program, individuals that are already in a DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program and how they're progressing. Individuals that withdrew from a DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program. We also have long-term tracking, and you could see beyond 1 year, if there is information available, you'll be able to see it for those individuals. Again, what the status is, are they progressing towards completing the DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program? Individuals that might have withdrawn from their apprenticeship program, individuals that might have reached journey person status in their DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program. So again, this is all part of the follow-up dashboard that is available at Illinois Works, in the Illinois Works reporting system, and is available for your program. So please learn how to use those. Again, go and review the recorded sessions that we have for IWRS and use them for your purposes, particularly as it relates to program improvement. Key outcome metrics. I mentioned earlier that we do allocation of funding based on enrollment, on completion, and transition, and then close our reports. I want to emphasize how these work so that if you have any questions about them, you can ask them. Grantees develop metrics in accordance with the Illinois Works guidelines in attachment to program planning two as part of your application. So when you submitted an application in response to our NOFO, attachment two was a required document. When we did negotiations with your organizations, we negotiated your enrollment metrics. So in other words, you might have said, I want to train 100 people, and then we negotiated a number. I want to train 50. I want to train 25 or 15. We negotiated a number per cohort, right? That negotiated number then ended up in your work plan, and it ends up also in your grant agreement. However, that's just the enrollment metrics, and we have the ability to negotiate that. The other ones we do not have the ability to negotiate. They are non-negotiable metrics, and it has to do with completion, and it has to do with transition. And here are the non-negotiable metrics. And these, again, are part of your grant agreement. At least 85% of individuals enrolled will successfully complete the pre-apprenticeship training program. This is very important, okay? 85% of individuals enrolled will successfully complete the pre-apprenticeship program. These are the metrics that we're using when we are releasing funding. So, and determining also your compliance status. At least 70% of individuals enrolled will be hired and enrolled in a DOL registered apprenticeship program. As I mentioned, Illinois Works exists to transition individuals to DOL registered apprenticeship programs. And we expect that at least 70% of individuals enrolled will be hired and enrolled in a DOL registered apprenticeship program. These metrics, along with your enrollment metrics, is what grant managers, Illinois Works grant managers, are checking on a monthly basis to see if you're progressing towards meeting those metrics for your program. We will discuss in a minute how the monitoring works and provide more details, but it's important that you know what these metrics are. Utilizing the dashboards and program reports, you can identify what your current standing is with Illinois Works. Not meeting expectations means performance outcomes are below expectations at this point in time. The current trajectory predicts programs will not be met. So if you're not meeting expectations, obviously you can see where you may end up not meeting your program goals at the end of the program year. Meeting expectation means performance outcomes are within the margins of expectations at this point in time. The current trajectory predicts program goals will be met. And exceeding expectations means performance outcomes are beyond the expectations at this point in time. The current trajectory predicts the program will exceed its goals. So you can make that determination. We will also provide to you monthly reports where we will tell you your official standing with Illinois Works, where you stand. And I will discuss those in a minute when we talk about program monitoring. So all metrics present potential opportunities for improvement. However, categories that are not meeting expectations should be a top priority for your program improvement planning. The 2023 grantee manual provides a hard copy of your grantee work plan in the appendix. The work plan is what we use to really base when and where you're going to be in your program throughout the program year. So I encourage you to make sure that you review where your work plan is and the type of information you submitted to us, because that's what we're going to be using to see how you're complying with Illinois Works. Before I close this section, I want to talk to you about our evaluation methodology. How do we evaluate this? And this is very important because we really want to make an impact in the community, and we do not know if we're making an impact if there is no formal evaluation. One of the steps and one of the important aspects of our evaluation methodology is the participant satisfaction survey. In keeping with the Illinois Works focus on continuous program improvement, both at a grantee and the network level, all pre-apprenticeship participants will remain engaged in the program through the end of instruction, even if they do not successfully complete the program, will be asked to provide feedback on their program experience through a participant satisfaction survey. This survey is a requirement, and grantees need to ensure that all their participants take it. So it's very important that all your participants that are there to the end, even if they did not successfully complete, that they fill out this survey. Information related to the participant satisfaction survey can be found on Section A of the grantee manual on page 4. The participant satisfaction survey was developed by Illinois Works in partnership with the Center for Government Studies at Northern Illinois University, and it will be an integral part of the program evaluation process. Besides page 134, you can also find more information related to the participant satisfaction survey on page 185 of the grantee manual. So program evaluation is very important to Illinois Works. We want to know if we're having the impact that we should be having. These are massive investments that are being made by the state of Illinois once the system, the network, is fully operational and doing everything it needs to do. The investment is anywhere between $25 to $30 million a year. So that's a lot of money being invested, and we want to know the impact we're having, and that we will know that through program evaluation. Illinois Works may employ several different approaches to evaluate pre-apprenticeship program. These evaluation approaches include implementation, outcome, and impact studies. So let's quickly summarize what these are so that you have an idea, and then we'll discuss the particular framework that we're doing, that we're using. Implementation studies, these document program operation and it compares it against goals across locations and over time. It describes and analyzes what happened and why, and is generally used to determine if a program is consistent with its goals, design, and other plan aspects. So those are implementation studies that is being used for Illinois Works. Our official evaluator is Northern Illinois University, and they'll be the ones producing these studies, and they will be published. Outcome studies. An outcome study compares individual outcomes against goals across programs or locations or over time. They determine if programs achieve their desired results by tracking participant outcomes after they complete or leave the pre-apprenticeship program. So outcome studies are very, very important for us, and they are also being used for Illinois Works. And then impact studies. Impact study estimates the difference in individual outcomes attributable to a specific program or policy. It answers the question, is the program the cause of the outcome? So impact studies are also part of our design. Why is this so important? Well, it is very important, and obviously all of our grantees are expected to fully participate and support these studies. The results of these evaluation studies will inform longer term outcomes and the impact that we're having in the state of Illinois. Now, these are also important because we need to report these to the Illinois Works Review Panel, which is an appointed panel appointed by the governor's office that reviews the impact that Illinois Works is having in the state of Illinois. We also need to report these to the governor's office and, more importantly, to the Illinois General Assembly so that they can see if the investments that we're making are having the intended impact. The particular approach that we're using at Illinois Works is a longitudinal study, a longitudinal approach. Each of these studies will have a longitudinal study design, which means that the study will look at variables over an extended period of time to determine, obviously, if we're having the impact. And this longer period of time is 10 years. We're going to be looking at individuals after they leave the program for up to 10 years to see where they are, the type of employment they have, the type of wages they have. So this longitudinal study will look to see if we prepare pre-apprentices for entry into construction and the building trades. It will also look to see if we increase the entry of women, people of color, and veterans into construction and the building trade apprenticeship programs. And it will also look to see if we increase the likelihood that women, people of color, and veteran apprentices will complete their apprenticeship programs in construction and the building trades. again, these studies supports our improvement plans, and they are a critical component of the Illinois Works Continuous Improvement Philosophy, which is vital for our program. The data from your follow-up activities that we have described before will also support these evaluation studies. Your timely and accurate follow-up during that period will be critical to the success of our Illinois Works longitudinal study. If you want more information related to follow-up and transition services, you can find that in the grantee manual, but also, our 2023 grantee manual session 3, which is already recorded and available in the partner guide, specifically addresses that. Any questions that we may have before we proceed to programmatic monitoring, which will be the last section I'll cover before we pass it on to our colleagues from the accountability office who will be talking about audits. Any questions, Vera Lee?
No questions in chat.
Okay, great. So moving on to programmatic monitoring, which is the last section I'm going to cover today, section 13 of the grantee manual. As I mentioned, the grantee manual has 14 sections, programmatic monitoring being probably one of the most important sections in this whole grantee manual. So I want to make sure that we do justice to it. Section 14 will deal with required audits, and our colleagues will cover that, but I want to make sure that we spend the time dealing with this. Programmatic monitoring, the objectives, describe the importance of program monitoring, adhere to the Illinois Works compliance review process, understand the two-level verification for completion and transition metrics, navigate the grant renewal process and carryover credits, respond to the progressive corrective action process, create and implement corrective action plans to get off the watch list and probation status and return to program compliance, attend quarterly administrator meetings to learn about network updates, and provide feedback on program progress. So again, this is one of the most important sections of this grantee manual, programmatic monitoring. Programmatic monitoring is the Illinois Works initiated activity for ensuring a program is making the expected incremental progress to achieve its goals within a defined timeframe as effectively as officially submitted to the Office of Illinois Works by each grantee using the work plan. The Illinois Works Grant Manager is primarily accountable for program monitoring. So you had an opportunity, you had the flexibility of creating your own work plan, submitting it to us, negotiating it with us. Once you do that, it's in place, and we use that work plan to then verify if you're progressing towards meeting your program goals. The grant manager's responsibilities include, but are not limited to, supporting the implementation of grant programs, ensuring budgets are within the scope of funding, enforcing regulatory compliance, ensuring grantees progress towards meeting required outcomes, enforcing progressive corrective action, and overall programmatic monitoring. Grantees are required to have an open door policy, and this is very important. As I mentioned, this is state funding and is regulated by state laws. Open door policy allowing for periodic visits. We may visit on site your facility to review your student files and other information so that we can verify your progress, and you need to provide documentation upon our request. Program staff, and this is very important, okay, so that you're not surprised, program staff, including our Illinois Works Grant Managers, can all contact with participants when needed. So if there's anything that comes up, a complaint, or any issue that comes up or something that is not adding up, we may directly communicate with your participants to be able to get information from them. And that's part of our monitoring process. The Illinois Works Grant Managers will conduct monthly compliance reviews to ensure grantees are adhering to program expectation based on the grant agreement and the approved work plan. During this process, a grantee's assigned Illinois Works Grant Manager will export participant data from the Illinois Works reporting system to determine each grantee's progress towards enrollment, completion, and primary transition goals. Based on the data entered in IWRS, your Illinois Works Grant Manager will assign one of the following overall progress rating based on the grantee's progress towards their enrollment, completion, and primary transition goals. So once they conduct that monthly compliance review, they will assign a rating to you, and they will send you reports indicating what your rating is based on their monthly compliance review. You could have an excellent progress rating, you can have a good progress rating, you can have an inadequate progress rating, or you can have a poor progress rating. Please keep in mind that we do not fund or renew funding for programs that are in poor progress. So it's very important that you really work hard to ensure your programs reach the good standing ratings, which are good progress and excellent progress, so that you can work through the renewal process. And we will discuss the renewal process in a minute. So you are subject to fiscal and programmatic monitoring visits by the department according to 200337. You are required to have policy for periodic visits by Illinois Works and DCO staff. And again, our staff may be contacting your program participants if we deem as necessary. Moving on, I'm going to skip the next activity. Completion and transition verification. Each outcome metric must be verified through data entered in IWRS. As I mentioned earlier, if the data is not in IWRS, we cannot use it for compliance purposes. Only data that is in IWRS can be used for compliance purposes. However, unlike enrollments, which are verified by information provided to Illinois Works exclusively from the grantee, completions and transitions, be it primary or secondary, require third-party verification. And we will discuss in a minute what that third-party verification is. Completion verifications require that a participant has successfully completed all the training modules in their attendance, post assessments and credentials have been entered into the corresponding training modules. Each participant must also have certificates or credentials uploaded for NCCR, NAPTU, ICCB, whatever your approved curricula is, OSHA 10, First Aid CPR, and any other certificates, if applicable, based on your grantee's approved curriculum. So all of you went through the process of getting your curriculum approved. Once that curriculum is approved, you need to follow that curriculum, and then you need to provide evidence of the achievement of participants for those particular credentials. Grantees should also upload an IWRS all roster to the organization's provider info tab under the file uploads an IWRS. So if you have already done training, you know where that is. If you have not done IWRS training, I encourage you to review the recorded sessions that we have or to reach out to your grant manager to receive one-on-one technical assistance on how to do this. But this is how we do verifications. Starting in 2023, there will be two levels of verification for a primary transition. First is a preliminary verification, and then is a final verification. Preliminary verification, the first level of confirmation that a completion or transition has taken place and acts as an interim metric while final verification documents are gathered. Preliminary verification carries a 75% outcome metric and reimbursement. Final verification, the second level of confirmation that a completion or a transition has taken place. This level verifies that a participant has successfully completed the Illinois Works Apprenticeship Program, has enrolled in a DOL Registered Apprenticeship Program, or has secured a secondary transition. Final verification carries a 25% outcome metric and reimbursement. We will discuss in a few minutes what the acceptable documents are for each of those levels of verification. So just stay tuned, and I'll cover that in a minute. Someone, Felina, is saying that she cannot hear me. Can someone confirm that you can hear me?
We can hear you.
Great. Good. Thank you. Felina, you may have to drop out of the webinar and then come back in. Typically, that fixes any issues that you may have. This system is designed to offer credit to programs to cover any time delays between achievement of a metric and securing full verification. It also incentivizes programs to quickly verify completions and, more importantly, to maintain connections with participants through full transitions into either enrollment in a registered apprenticeship program or securing a secondary transition. It is important to know that a participant does not always have to go through both verification levels. For example, if a participant has required documentation for a full transition, they will be automatically granted to have a final verification for their primary transition. Secondary transitions can be accepted once they have reached a final verification stage. There is no preliminary verification for a secondary transition. This will become clear for you when I talk about the third-party documentation that is required. So let me go into that first. I mentioned earlier that the main reason for our existence is transitioning individuals to DOL registered apprenticeship programs, but there are individuals that change their minds or are not able to get accepted into a DOL registered apprenticeship program. Those individuals can achieve a secondary transition, and we will give you credit for that, not at the same level as a primary transition, but you will get credit and we're able to verify that. Third-party documentation depends on the level of verification, be it preliminary or final. Here are some examples of accepted documents. However, this list is not exhaustive. If you have documentation that you think could be used and you want to pass it by you, please communicate with your grant manager to gain approval for that document. So completion documentation, all required credential certifications offered by the grantee, including NCCR, NAPTU, ICCB certificates, OSHA 10 certifications, first our certifications, all of those are acceptable verifications, completion verifications. if you use an alternative system besides your core certifications, let's say for flagger certification or forklift or CDL or others, you need to also upload those into the system. Grantees must also upload completed rosters for each module on the organization's provider page in IWRS. Those are all acceptable third-party verifications of completion. For verification for transition documentation, you can use for a preliminary verification, you can use a Register Apprenticeship Program application confirmation or a full application, a receipt from a Register Apprenticeship Program showing the application fees were paid, a notice of testing, a letter or email from a Register Apprenticeship Program confirming the participant's application. Any documentation outlining that the individual is also on a waiting list can be used. That is for preliminary verification. However, for final verification of a primary transition, the only thing we would accept is acceptance letter to a Register Apprenticeship Program, sponsorship letter from an employer. Those are the two acceptable documents right now. And as I said earlier, if there are other documents that you feel can be used, communicate with your grant manager and we can discuss it. If they approve it, you can certainly use them. Secondary transition, there's only final verification here that we will accept, pay stub, employment offer letter, acceptance letter to higher education or an advanced training program, among others. So depending what the primary transition is what the type of documents that we will accept there. If you want more guidance related to this, please go to page 191 of the grantee manual. You'll find information there. And also the types of documents that are accepted. Continuing here with the compliance process and also the monthly review. Once an overall progress rating is determined each month, each grantee will be emailed two monthly reports. So your program administrator will receive two monthly reports from our office. These typically are released the first to second week of the month after we have done our monthly compliance review. So the two reports you'll receive are called the monthly compliance progress report and the monthly compliance payment worksheet. The Illinois Works Grant Manager is primarily accountable for program monitoring, including the monthly compliance review. The Illinois Grant Managers will conduct monthly compliance reviews to ensure grantees are adhering to program expectations based on your grant agreement and also the approved work plan. If you want more information related to the monthly compliance review, please go to page 177 of the grantee manual for more guidance. But let's discuss these reports and how they work. So the monthly compliance progress report provides the grantee with the overall progress rating. So it will tell you if you're in good standing, you are in excellent standing, if you are inadequate status, the increase to your reimbursement cap based on the month's review, and any notes regarding your progress rating and any relevant data trends identified in the review. Information detail in the progress report is only a snapshot of what was entered in IWRS since the previous month's compliance review. So this monthly compliance progress report, it's only summarizing data for that previous month. So when they send you a report, let's say in September, they're giving you the compliance that they did for August for you. So only for the data that you entered in August. This is not an aggregate report. It only shows enrollments, completions, and transitions since the last monthly compliance progress report. Now, the monthly compliance payment worksheet is an aggregate worksheet that outlines your total number of enrollments for the program year, your total number of completions, your total number of primary transitions and secondary transitions. This report also provides grantees with a detailed outline of your custom performance-based payment funding formula and the reimbursement maximum and grant award information. Section 11, Finances, Records, and Reporting has more information related to this. You can also find more guidance related to this on page 193 of the grantee manual. So those are the two monthly reports you're going to be receiving as part of our compliance checking. You will get them from your grant managers. If you have any questions, you can certainly ask them. We also schedule technical assistance as a result of these reports and what the standing that you are in a particular moment in time. Let me quickly address the grantee renewal process because this is very important. If you have not worked with the state before, some of this information is definitely going to be new, but I want to make sure that if you have questions about this, I answer them. So according to GARA, and as explained in the notice of funding opportunity for each of our years, you have the opportunity to renew your grant 2 times. So you are all grantees. You'll have an opportunity to go through 2 renewal years without having to competitively apply for the grant. Including the initial grant year, the 2 additional renewals allow grantees to implement the Illinois Works Pre-Apprenticeship Program for a maximum of 3 years to reapply through the merit-based competitive process. So if you already got a grant from us, you can have 2 renewals before you will have to apply again competitively to get this grant. In the fall of each year, this is the way the process works. In the fall of each year, Illinois Works will alert grantees that they have been invited to renew their grant agreement. Grantees will be invited to renew based on their program performance. This is very important. We do not automatically renew grantees. It is all based on your performance. The performance threshold to qualify for renewal will be provided to grantees in August of each program year. So in August, we will let you know what the performance threshold is for renewal. Is it 65%? Is it 70%? Is it 75% performance? So it's very important that you pay attention to that. If you are not offered renewal, it's because you may not have reached that performance threshold. Grantees are given 3 opportunities to reach that performance threshold. And if they do not reach that performance threshold in the 3rd opportunity, their grant will not be renewed. Grantees are invited to renew, will be asked to submit a grant renewal application. This application may include a grant application form, a proposed work plan, a proposed curriculum, a staffing plan, a marketing plan, a program improvement plan, an updated budget, and the state required disclosure forms. Additional forms or information may be requested by Illinois Works if deemed necessary. If you want more guidance related to the renewal process, you can go to page 193 of the grantee manual and you will see the guidance there. Verilee, are there any questions before I go to carry over credit and then end with the corrective action process?
No questions in chat.
Okay, great. Carry over credit. So this particular change in guidance resulted from feedback that was the grantees last year. And this is a very important change that will impact those grantees that are offered renewal. Due to the timing of programming and cycles of registered apprenticeship program enrollment periods, it is possible that a participant will attend training in 1 grant year, but not complete or fully transition until the following grant year or beyond. As a result, carryover credit will be provided to grantees for their pre-apprentice graduate related outcome metrics if the completion or transition takes place within the same grant agreement as the original enrollment. What does that mean? Illinois Works pre-apprenticeship grant agreements last a maximum of 3 years. The initial grant year followed by 2 renewals. These renewals are extensions of the original grant agreement. After the 2nd renewal, GARA requirements dictate that grantees must reapply and go through a competitive bid process. This officially closes the original grant agreement and begins a new grant agreement, also with the possibility of 2 new grant renewals. Grant renewals are not automatically offered to grantees. So how does this play out? So this is the way it plays out. If a participant is enrolled in the initial grant year, their carryover credit will apply to renewal year 2. So if you had an individual that enrolled in year 1, they had to stop, and then they came back and finished their program in year 2, and then they completed and transitioned in year 2, you will get credit, financial credit, for those individuals in that year when they completed and transitioned. If a participant is enrolled in year 1, the carryover credit will only be applied to renewal year 2. If a participant enrolls in renewal year 2, there will be no carryover credit, If a grantee has gone through a new competitive bid process for Illinois Works, any completions or transitions will not carry over into the new grant agreement. So we can only offer you carryover credit within the 3-year window that you have, but you can significantly benefit if you continue to work with your enrollees to make sure that they complete and transition within that 3-year window. Any further guidance related to this item can be found on page 194 of the grantee manual. Now I'm going to close with a couple of items, one of them being very important, and that's progressive corrective action. Unfortunately, there are programs that do not progress well to meet the required metrics and to meet the requirements of Illinois Works, and as a result, they may have to go through our progressive corrective action process. Grantees must adhere to program expectations and requirements outlined in the Illinois Works Pre-Apprenticeship Program Manual in their grant agreement. Again, through our monthly program review, we will determine the standing of the program in relation to our and if they are not progressing well, the grant manager will then propose corrective action for particular grantees. And there are 3 levels of corrective action. The first level is warning. If you are given a warning, you will need to submit a corrective action plan that you put together in partnership with your grant manager. A warning is a formal notification that expectations have not been met. It is issued if a grantee has not made enough progress for a required outcome for 2 consecutive months with a status of inadequate progress or poor progress. If you're not able to get out of the warning with your corrective action plan, you may end up on the watch list. The watch list is designated to identify and assist non-compliant grantees to improve performance and participant outcomes. It is issued if a grantee has not made enough progress for a required outcome for 3 consecutive months with a status of inadequate progress or poor progress. Now, probation also requires a corrective action plan, but probation is a serious situation for a particular grantee. Probation is designed to actively monitor programs that fail to meet compliance with required program activities, performance benchmark, and/or fiscal and administrative rules. If a grantee is found to be seriously violating the rules of Illinois Works or the state require regulations and mandates from the state, they can be automatically put on probation. Failure to address the outlined expectations as stated in the grant and within 3 months after being placed on probation can result in the grantee we may reduce the grantee's funding. We may also close their agreement, and unfortunately they may not qualify for future Illinois Works funding. So those are all corrective actions that we may take against grantees that are not progressing to meeting their goals, and it's important that you really read the guidance in the manual related to this. There's a lot of guidance there, and it's important to really understand how that works. Final point before I hand it over to my colleagues to discuss audits is quarterly administrative meetings. These meetings are designed by the Office of Illinois Works to present on grantee network progress, upcoming changes to programming, reporting, or important deadlines. This is also a time where the program administrators are encouraged to ask questions, make comments, and offer ideas on how to enhance our program. There are 4 meetings that are scheduled throughout the year, and program administrators, important here, are required to attend them all. For 2 of the meetings, attendance is required in person. One will take place at a regional meeting, and the other one at the annual conference. These are in-person events. And then there are 2 other meetings throughout the year that will happen virtually. So those are quarterly administrative meetings. Again, they're required of program administrators. Any questions, Vera Lee, in the chat before I pass it on to Sue and Amber to finalize the last section related to audit requirements?
No questions in chat, Norman.
Okay, great. So thank you very much again, Sue and Amber, for joining us today. Please go ahead and discuss the last section of the grantee manual, which is audit requirements.
All right. Hi, everyone. My name is Amber Broughton, and Sue Ridings is also going to be working on this section with me. We are with the Office of Accountability. We are technical support managers. And this section is going to be about audit requirements. So let's see, we're going to be talking about GATA. We're going to be talking about 2 CFR 200. We're going to be talking about the different audit types and the audit submission requirements. All right, so the state of Illinois requires that all grantees comply with federal audit requirements. This section will be an overview of the type of entities that are required to submit an audit. For information regarding audit requirements and compliance, you can visit the audit report review manual or contact your Illinois Works grant manager. And I'll just give a little plug for our new grant help desk. So Sue and I and a couple of our colleagues, we have started last month actually a grant help desk, and the email for that is ceo.granthelp@illinois.gov. You can also go to the DCEO website, and under grant opportunities, there's a form that you could fill out. But this is basically our main audience for this is brand new grantees, people that haven't had a grant with the state before, helping them get registered on the GATA grantee portal, making sure that all those pre-qualifications are good to go. So you guys are, you know, ahead of this because you are in it. You are grantees. But you know, just keep that in mind, that email. And we also will answer any questions you have, or direct you to the right person. So it's ceo.granthelp@illinois.gov. Okay. So not all grantees are required to submit an audit based on federal audit requirements. Audit requirements are based on single audit conducted in accordance with, general accepted auditing standards, or audit conducted in accordance with generally accepted governmental auditing standards. So GAGAS. Those are the different types. Go to the next slide. So this is a flow chart of kind of determining where your entity is and what type of audit it's going to be. But if you go into the GATA grantee portal and you begin to fill out your auditing reports, the very first thing you do is you fill out a survey, and that survey will determine what sort of audit you need to do. So I wouldn't worry too much about this. And of course, we're available and your grant manager is available to help you through this. But this just kind of gives an overview of what sort of audit you might be doing. So let's see, got a grantee that expends $750,000 or more during the grantee's fiscal year in federal awards from all sources must have a single audit. A grantee that expends less than $750,000 during the grantee's fiscal year in federal awards from all sources is exempt from a federal audit. Grantees who expend less than $750,000 from all sources are subject to the following audit requirements. Let's see. So grantees, I'm giving a lot of numbers here, sorry, but it's all in the audit manual. Grantees who expend $500,000 or more during the grantee's fiscal year in state, direct, federal, or federal pass-through funds. Grantees who do not meet requirements in subsection A, but expend $300,000 or more during the non-federal entity's fiscal year. Grantees who do not meet the requirements in subsection A or B, but have audits conducted voluntarily or based on other regulatory requirements, must submit those audits for review. So let's see, in your grantee manual on page 185, that will go into additional details about this audit criteria. And then also when you when it is time to go to the GATA grantee portal, it'll also give you information on that. So once you find out what type of audit you need to do, then that will dictate what sort of documents need to be submitted through that GATA grantee portal. So it could be a single audit report package, it could be a financial statement audit or an on-site review or PTE agreement, or it might be an audit not required or no audit conducted. It really just depends on what sort of audit is deemed appropriate for your entity. So the next slide, we have a Mentimeter question. Which is your audit type? So let's see. And this is just if you have an idea of the amount of money that you would be getting from the state, what sort of audit do you believe you will be asked to conduct? Right. And you won't be held accountable for this little survey right here. This is just to kind of give us an idea of where you might be at when you're doing your audit package. Okay, so probably that right in the middle, the generally accepted auditing standards will probably be the likely audit for several of you. All right, thank you. I'll turn it over to Sue.
Thank you, Amber. Hello, everyone. I'm going to discuss the three audit requirement types that Amber's gone over. The single audit report package is the first one, and it's for grantees that expend $750,000 or more in federal funds. Now, it's due 30 days after the audit report completion, but no longer than 9 months after the end of the grantee's fiscal year. This audit requires financial statements, schedule of expenditures of federal awards, summary schedule of prior audit findings, the auditor's report, corrective action plans, management letters issued by the auditors, consolidated year-end financial report within relation to opinion, and the state data collection form. Next slide. The second type is the financial statement audit, and this is for grantees that expend between $300,000 and $749,999. This is in a combination of state and federal awards. It's due 30 days after the audit completion, but no longer than 6 months after the grantee's fiscal year end. This type of an audit requires financial statements, the statement summary of prior audit findings, the auditor's report. It also requires a generally accepted governmental auditing standards requirement, which is a report on internal controls over financial reporting and compliance. Also in the audit package, we need the corrective action plan, the management letters issued by auditors, the consolidated year-end financial report within relation to opinion, and the state data collection form. Now we're going into the third type. Next slide, please. Which is the audit not required and no audit conducted. Now, this is for grantees who have spent less than $300,000 in federal and state funds. And although there's no audit required, you still need to upload a consolidated year-end financial report. This is due 30 days after completion, but no later than 6 months after the grantee's fiscal year. And with all of these audit packages, it's imperative to remember that that non-compliance with audit requirements could result in the implementation of the Grantee Compliance Enforcement System, or the GCES, and it may result in the inability to receive grant funds, and nobody wants that. Next slide, audit submissions. Okay, financial statement audits and the consolidated year-end financial report for those that don't require to have an audit are uploaded into the GATA system. But for the single audit package, these must be submitted by the grantee to the Federal Audit Clearinghouse, or the FAC. These are due 30 calendar days after receipt of the auditor's report and 9 months after the end of the grantee's audit period, the earlier of the two. Along with the submission to the FAC, there is still state compliance items that need to be uploaded into the GATA system. They need to be uploaded within 30 days of the FAC submission or 9 months after the grantee's fiscal year end, whichever comes first. And these items include management letters issued by the auditors, if applicable, consolidated year-end financial reports with relation to opinion, and the auditor's peer review letter. Now, if you need any more information on anything that we've gone over, please see section 5A of the GATA Audit Report Review Process Manual. And I believe that there's going to be a link to that manual in the chat. And that concludes our portion. And if anyone has any questions, please either unmute yourself or put the question in the chat. If Amber and I can't answer your question now, we will get back to you with the answer.
No questions in chat.
Okay. Thank you, Sue and Amber, for your presentation today. We really appreciate it. I want to pass it on now to Gia for a final evaluation and close out of our webinar today.
Great, thank you, Norman. So if you could, if you have logged out of Mentimeter, just quickly log back in. Verily will make sure that the Mentimeter information is available for you in the chat. And we just have a couple questions for you regarding the program today. Thank you, Verily. And of course, the first question is, please share your views on this training by writing the following statements, from 1 being the lowest and 10 being the highest. To what extent did it meet your expectations? How likely are you to attend a similar event in the future? And how likely are you to recommend this training to others? And right now we have 8 respondents. Okay, thank you. The next question is, this course was relevant to what I wanted to learn about the subject matter. right, next question. I plan to apply what I learned. Okay, thank you. The next one is, what improvements might you recommend? Okay, this is helpful. Any other thoughts? Okay. All right, thank you. Okay, what did you find effective? So if we make changes, what would you recommend we keep? Okay, thank you. And this is our last question. Is there anything else about this course you think we should know? Okay, so while you are responding to this last question, and please do continue to respond. In the meantime, I'm going to turn this back over to Dr. Ruana.
Thank you, Gia, for doing the evaluation. I want to thank all of you for being part of this webinar today. As I mentioned, the recording of this webinar will be made available in the partner guide in the next day or so. Please tune in and go to the partner guide in case you're interested in reviewing it. We are almost at the end of our onboarding process with Eleanor Works. There's only 2 webinars left, one specifically for administrators related to coaching and the coaching assessment that needs to be completed. And the final one is an IWRS, the Eleanor Works Reporting System. It's a technology webinar. Presently scheduled for Thursday. We will let you know if there are any changes that happen to these webinars, but those are the last 2 webinars related to onboarding, and we hope to see you then. Thanks again for joining us. I hope you have a good rest of your day. Bye-bye.